Typically, our workshops are not quite as formal, but we decided we'd better sit up here because we thought there might be a lack of seating down there. And since we do have a good crowd this evening, why don't we all stand up and do a Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'm getting the hang.
Generally, if we have folks in the audience, we'll ask the audience to identify themselves, but I don't think we're going to bother doing that tonight. But I would ask the counselors, and starting with Henry, if they just introduce themselves.
My name is Henry Berry, and I'm on the town council, and I live on Tulich Road.
John McGinty.
Carol Fritz.
I'm Mike McGovern, the town manager.
And Jack Roberts, chair of the council.
I'm Deborah Lane, the municipal clerk.
Mary Ann Lynch, town council.
Ann Swift Kayata, town council.
Penny Carson.
Look, I forget the name. What we're going to do this evening, I'm going to ask Councilor Lynch if she'd give us a brief introduction since Mary Ann had brought the proposal before us. And then we'll ask the public to come up to the podium and speak. Last night I asked people to limit to 3 to 5 minutes, and I really gave some people an awful lot of latitude. So with the number of people we have, and most of us got to bed last night about midnight, so we are going to try to hold people to 3 minutes. So if you got the stick to your most salient point and get that across, and then I'm sure everything else that people may have is going to come across as well. We are going to try to hold people to the 3 minute limitation on speaking so we don't spend the entire evening here. And again, I would ask folks not to applaud or be booing anybody else's position. Keep it as civil as possible. There are a lot of passions on both sides of the issue. And I would also, due to a different Warwick, Rhode Island, again mentioned tonight that there's an exit out that way and there is an exit this way. So if we have too much heat, not enough light, you know how to get out anyway. So with that, I would ask Councilor Lynch if she would give us an introduction of what she has brought forward.
First, I want to thank everyone. I can say this for the entire council, all of you for coming, all of the emails and telephone calls that we have. It's truly a privilege to serve in a town where the citizenry becomes so involved and so educated, and it makes our jobs easier, frankly, in some ways, because we know what it is you want at the end. So I don't want to spend any time talking about the specifics of the proposal. I think it's been in the newspaper. You're all familiar with it. But I do want to take just a couple of minutes to talk about why I brought it before the council. This year, I'm chairman of the Finance Committee. If you've read the papers, we are looking at close to a $500,000 cut in state aid to the schools, reductions in municipal revenue sharing, reductions in other town revenues. With that, it seemed to me that we have three options when the state imposes that kind of magnitude of a cut. And I also want to emphasize this is a cut on top of last year's cut from the state. We can, as we've done in the past, turn to the homeowners and raise your taxes. We can cut municipal services, as we have done, like the spring cleanup, and this year on the chopping block, hazardous waste cleanup collection, police cruiser replacement, library acquisition, all before us this year in the town manager's budget that he has just sent to us. We can cut school programs and teachers, and we can also look for other sources of revenue. This is an issue that came up last year in our budget discussions with the school board. Why? Because the school pointed out to us they are not in a position to raise revenues from other sources, but the town is. Now, the schools make up approximately 75% of every tax dollar we raise and 64% of the town expenditures. Long before we were organized to provide for pools and fitness centers, towns were providing for the schools. So they're not a special interest. They are a major interest along with the other things that we do to ensure the health and safety of the citizens. So I felt that when we are faced with these kinds of cuts, we have an obligation to find out what the people who've elected us want us to do to soften the blows to the school and the town. Should we get by with fewer police cruisers and eliminate spring cleanup? Should we raise taxes, and if so, by how much? Should we look for other sources of revenue? Again, only the town council has the ability to raise revenue. As the editors of the Portland Press Herald said in an editorial on March 7th, it would be nice if Fort William stayed a free park, but times being what they are, one cannot blame Cape Elizabeth or any other municipality for adopting user fees. User fees are one of the few ways that municipalities have of diversifying their revenue base. Cape isn't the first town to contemplate them, and it won't be the last. And I agree with that editorial, with one exception. Fort Williams has never been free. The homeowners of Cape Elizabeth have been paying for that. I truly believe that we owe the town this kind of discussion, and I'm gratified that we have had this kind of discussion. On a humorous note, my 10-year-old came home from school last week and said, "Mom, you want to hear a really dumb idea?" I said, "Sure." He said, "Somebody on the town council wants to charge people going into Fort William. Can you believe it?" I said, "I hope you're going to stop that next week." So, we have had a great discussion in our town, in our houses. I know many, many school children have had this as a good discussion.
When is young grounded is what I want to know.
Pardon me?
How long is he going to be grounded?
But we need to have these kinds of discussions periodically because we are making choices. I suspect in the end that we will have to do a little of all of the three things that I talked about. So I know for the council we appreciate your emails. I can say, several of us said this last night to the school folks, we haven't had a chance to respond to all the emails between the school project and Fort Williams. I know I have about 75 emails. I've read them all, but we haven't yet had a chance to respond to them. But we appreciate that. We appreciate your phone calls. And most importantly, we appreciate your coming out tonight to let us know what you think, not just about Fort Williams, but about the trade-offs that we have to make. So with that, I will.
Thank you. And last night I did ask people if they were interested in standing to show their support or opposition to the project. I know a lot of people, if they know that we know what they're here for, don't necessarily care to go to the podium. So I think I'll do that again this evening. And how many people, by show of hands, are here in support of the fees? Thank you. How many people here are opposed to a fee being implemented? And how many people are here just for the entertainment value? Very good. Again, when you come to the podium, please limit your comments to the 3 minutes. We are going to hold people to that. It would be helpful if you did line up so that we don't have to wait for people going to the podium. And you can start now. And Bill, do you want to start, did you? Or?
I don't care to start. However, I would request that the television camera and reporter relieve that corner. Not all of us are good speakers in front of a television camera stuffed in our face.
Thanks. You have the right to be in.
He has the right to be there, but I would ask, would it be possible to pull it back just a little ways so you're not right in the speaker's faces?
And he might free up the podium for people that need it for papers.
There you go, good. Thank you. If you would just give your name and address, and you can begin.
Yes, my name is Harold Littlefield. I live at 6 Lawson Road. I'm a 25-year resident of the town. Councilors, citizens, and manager of Cape Elizabeth, I'm not in favor of fees for parking at Fort Williams Park. What I would like to see happen is for the town council to become one of the first towns in the state to adopt a new property tax plan. With the reevaluation of property tax base and improvements needed for the high school and Pond Cove School, it is time to factor all of these together come up with a stable tax base. After a base has been established, any property tax increase cannot be more than 3% a year. This amount would be reduced with the reappraisal of property sold or transferred at a current market rate for the property. The buyers and receivers of property would then set a new baseline at the higher valuation. I would also include any improvements of over 20% would be appraised. This would also include any total improvements of 20%, meaning if you improved it 15% one year and 5% another year, your property would have to be reappraised to establish a new tax baseline. This does not relieve the council, school board, and town manager of keeping costs as low as possible. I am not in favor of charging for parking at Fort Williams Park.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ellie Baker, and I live on Coalfield Road, Cape Elizabeth 27. And forgive me if I'm not real coherent. I'm a tax accountant, and it's snowing. And I'm kind of depressed right now, so I am not in favor of admission fees to Fort Williams. I'm pretty much a lifelong resident. I moved here when I was 10, and I had a few years when I was in college and law school, and when I couldn't afford to live in Cape Elizabeth, then I lived elsewhere. But since I could afford it, I've been here. And Fort Williams was a big part of my growing up, a big part of my adulthood, and I want to see it remain, maybe not free because we do pay for it, but certainly open to the public, an open access point. I am really here representing the Fort Williams Charitable Foundation, which was established in June of 2001. Jeff Van Fleet sent you a letter, I hope you all got a copy of it, outlining our position. But I want to quickly reiterate a few of the points that he made and kind of put a little personal touch on it if I can. The mission of the Charitable Foundation is really twofold. One is to establish an endowment that will support the park forever, we hope. And the second is to fund specific improvements that were recommended or will be recommended by the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and that are approved by you all. We haven't been around that long. We've been establishing ourselves. But my biggest motivation for agreeing to serve on that Charitable Foundation board was to help find a way to keep the park free and open to all. The foundation hasn't been given enough time to do its job. Just hasn't. We would like to see a fund exist so that this doesn't happen every year, or every 2 years, or every 5 years, or every 50 years, or however often it might. But if a fee is imposed, we fear that any potential donations are going to just dry up. They're not going to exist. It's tough enough trying to raise money for a park in the richest town in Maine. But it's impossible, I think, if a fee is charged. Let me just tell you why I feel so strongly about this, and then I will shut up. The citizens of this community are part of a much larger community. They're part of the state of Maine, they're part of the greater Portland community, they're part of this nation and world. This, Fort Williams, is a public treasure. We aren't charged to go see other public treasures or to be in other public treasures like Deering Oaks, Eastern Prom, Ocean Walk on Eastern Prom, Back Bay, Mill Creek, Willard, Portland, South Portland, etc., roads, police, fire protection, Maine Medical Center, which is supported by the City of Portland, and all other not-for-profit institutions that take away from the tax base.
Okay. Alice, you do need to summarize there.
Thank you.
All right, thank
you. Cape Elizabeth can afford, just one more line, can afford to keep Fort Williams free and open, either through their charitable donations or through their taxes. In either case, they are totally deductible. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good talk.
Stickman.
Al Barthelman, 1247 Sawyer Road in Cape Elizabeth. I'm chair of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, and I wanted to go early so I can be on the 11 o'clock news. Actually, I want to go early so that I can give some facts and figures and some of the position of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. I also very much want to separate my own personal opinion, as you can see, from that. So I'll try to get as quickly as possible through some of the facts, and hopefully I got a minute at the end to tell you what I feel myself. I've been on the Fort Williams Advisory Commission for, I'm trying to talk too fast, 4 to 5 years. I was elected to the chair position in January. I've chaired 2 meetings. So I'm new to that role. And in our first 2 meetings, we have not been able to discuss the issue of fees. I want to be clear about that. The reason not is that we've been working very hard to wrap up the master plan, and I'm very pleased to be able to use the word wrap up because that's going to print right now. So that's a long, lot of hard work that's finally coming to a close. And we also, of course, have presented the budget for the special revenue fund for the fort as to expenditures recommended for next year from that fund. We have not had a detailed discussion, so there's not a position on the part of the Advisory Commission. I can tell you, and I'll speak on their behalf as from knowing them personally, we currently have 6 members. 2 of those members are new enough that they have not really had the opportunity to form an opinion. One person is for fees, and I would say the other 3 are against fees to one extent or another. So it's 3 against 1, 1 for. And they can come up and speak if they disagree with that. Our experience has been, we were commissioned by the Town Council in 1995 to do a study, and our 1999 to do a study as to how to make the fort self-sufficient, and the charitable foundation that Ellie just spoke about is the outcome of the study that I was involved in 1999 as the way that the fort should be made to become self-sufficient. People that have come on the Advisory Commission in general, if they came on with the feeling that there should be fees or either for parking or entrance, have moved to the position, most of them have moved to the position of being against fees as they understood the administrative issues, the cost issues, and so forth of doing this type of thing. So what I'm telling you is that the people have really gotten into the details, have been generally moving against fees. And I also want to assure you that we have always entered these discussions, from my experience, in a very open-minded fashion. We did not go into them with the idea of how we're going to shoot down fees. But it goes down paths of expenses and so forth. We are, as the Advisory Commission, are responsible for making recommendations on the budget for the Special Revenue Fund, which is funds that are earned from within the park, and that means the rental buildings and so forth. And just for general knowledge, that generally raises, in the current fiscal year, is going to raise about $55,700. Now, what we do with that money is capital improvements. One of the things we recommended this year, for example, is to replace the playground set there, which has become dangerous and really needs to be replaced badly. The operations maintenance budget and maintenance budget is what we're talking about tonight. The cost of that has gone up gradually to $120,000, and that's the amount that we're talking about coming out of the taxpayers' contributions. I want to be clear that the percentage of that that's about 1.4% of the municipal budget as it is being submitted, 1.4%. And the municipal budget is the non-school part of the Cape Elizabeth budget. It's about 0.43% of the total Cape Elizabeth budget. That's what that 120,000 represents, 0.43%. And those percentages have stayed quite consistent since the 1995 study was done, interestingly. So those costs have gone up, but pretty much in direct proportion to the growth of our population and increases in taxes. So those are some numbers I wanted to give people for future discussion.
Al, you do need to try to...
Okay, I understand strongly the current dilemma. I'm strongly against fees for philosophical reasons, which I would probably say about what Ellie just said, in terms of we live in a larger community with many parks that we enjoy. Practically, it goes back to the fact that I have seen that once you get into the costs and other issues of actually doing this, I do not believe that the kind of money that is being talked about would in fact be raised. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, councilors. My name is Catherine Kramer Howe,
and I live at 9 Steeplebush Road, and I've been a resident in Cape Elizabeth for 20 years. And I had my children time me this afternoon so I wouldn't go over my 3 minutes. So, I sat here last night and heard how hard our school building advisory committee has been working on the kindergarten and high school project over the past 3 years. When I looked at this morning's paper and I saw the headline, Cape Council puts off kindergarten decision, I was embarrassed. We are only talking about a $1.5 million project. The question of whether or not to impose fees at Fort Williams is surfacing once again and at a very opportune time. Years ago, the residents of Cape Elizabeth voted in favor of maintaining Fort Williams. We have done this over the years with a great deal of pride. However, the financial climate in our state and town has changed. Year after year, the state continues to cut monies for the general purpose aid for our schools. My questions are, how can we raise additional money without taxing the people in our community? And will people on fixed incomes be able to continue to live here if our taxes are increased? I would hate to lose one senior citizen because they couldn't afford to pay their taxes. Without raising taxes, where are we going to find the additional money to help support our community? In 1998, the Cape Courier conducted a survey which indicated that 60% of the people polled were in favor of a non-resident fee for Fort Williams. Perhaps it is time to vote again on this issue. We have heard about the hassle factor that would occur in order to implement a fee. I have also heard of simple solutions to these issues. We have heard that Deering Oaks, Bug Light, and Back Bay are free, but we are not comparing apples to apples. Portland and South Portland have a huge commercial base. We do not. Personally, I feel that the $5 entry fee into the park is more than reasonable. I would advocate for a higher fee for non-residents and an even higher fee for commercial vehicles. In an ideal world, all parks would be free. However, this is not an ideal world. We need to put aside our pride and show some humility in asking help to maintain this breathtaking landmark. Thank you for giving us an opportunity this evening to speak.
Thank you.
Well, I guess I'm next. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. And,
Bill, can you introduce yourself, please?
My name is Bill Lowell, and I'm a volunteer very happily at the museum gift shop. And if you could see the amount of people that come in there and spend their money. Last year, I think we took in, not knowing exactly, over $500,000. And that goes into the park. Now, I fear that if we charge a fee, that goes into what we call the general fund. Now, where the hell does that go? We really don't know. There are a lot of hands and a lot of people that are interested in it. As I said, we took in almost $500,000 last year in that little two-car garage that we have out there. I think the best thing that the Cape did back in 1970 was to invest $200,000 and see what jewel we have today. I feel that if we do put a fee in here, and we have people that come all over the world, and I know they're there for a limited amount of time, and they don't care about spending $500 or $5 to go in, even though they don't know. Now, we hear so much people coming from around the world, thank you, Kate, for giving us this beautiful spot. It's our jewel. We want to give the jewel, not have the other people pay to see our jewel. Let's see. I've seen people at Two Lights. I get out of Two Lights every Sunday, That's my church. I've seen people turn right around when the state charges them $2 to go in. They don't want to pay. I said, some people do, but not a lot that do. So it's that turnaround which we have to visualize, because some people want to go out there and they'll say, I don't want to give you $5. We have the trolleys that come out. That's another cost for the trolley people and so forth. Has it ever been suggested that we have Friends of Fort Williams? It's something to discuss. I just got to communicate through the Victoria Mansion. And they want me to belong and be a friend of the Victoria Mansion. Why couldn't we have a Friends of Fort Williams? That's another place we could get some revenue. So, to end this little conversation, it's so nice to see many people out here tonight. And even though Mary Ann Lynch, I don't know, I don't hold this against you, because you have a purpose in mind and trying to relieve us taxpayers. I've lived out here since 1960. Henry Berry knows. So anyway, thank you very much for allowing me to talk.
Thank you.
Luke Pitsler from Old Fort Road. And that was an impressive list of alternative sources of revenue that Mary Ann gave us. I think the only thing she left out was a bake sale. And I would hate to see fees charged for Fort Williams. The buses have threatened to find the other places to stop on their tours if we charge them. They may not, but with gas prices going up, it's more likely that they will cut somewhere. And the major source of income at that little gift shop comes from the people on the buses. And it's an impressive income. And I would hate to see, for another reason, because if you start charging fees, it becomes a commercial thing. And very subtly, attitudes change. The people who volunteer might not feel so willing to. That gift shop has only 2 salaried employees. The rest are volunteers. And when you consider the costs of having to pay employees and hire employees, I don't know how much revenue you're going to have left to put into the general fund. Who volunteer there cherish that place, and most people do. I think a lot of people take it for granted and seldom visit it. But as a for instance, I was volunteering in the garden there one day when a beautiful summer day, a bus tour stopped from New York City, and it was not a deluxe tour.
Ruth, you need to summarize.
Older folks got off and made their way down toward the light. And I overheard an elderly gentleman say, if I could live in a place like this, I'd think I'd died and gone to heaven. So let's not deprive anyone of visiting the forts.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Eric Copperman. I live on 10 Highview Road. We live in the most affluent community in the state of Maine, but I am here to represent the people within our community who are not the most affluent. I work for the United States Postal Service. I'm a rural carrier. I am a proud resident of this town. One of the wonderful things about this town that is I can bounce from Fort Williams to Gulf Crest. I can bounce from Robinson Woods to other people's properties that are wide open. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. My children play at Fort Williams. They go snow tubing at Fort Williams. I go there to fly kites with my six-year-old, watching the sunset with the headlight in the background. I'm a transplant here from New York City, where there's a fee for everything. And whether you like it or not, there is resentment between different classes of people in New York City about who can afford to do things and who can't afford to do things. Please do not do this to our town. Where does it stop? It's Fort Williams one day, Golf Crest the next day. I share my property with anybody who wants to go on it. Other people share their property. I appreciate that. I personally, when I'm on the road, when I go by a town like Freeport, where they do charge fees in some parks, it's a couple of bucks, but you know what? With my car, with my family, I drive by it. I don't want to see that happen in our town. So, as far as solving the budget shortfalls, I took an oath to the Constitution of the United States when I joined the service. I serve the people of this community, not for a lot of money. I don't make a lot of money. But maybe some people here can have that same attitude and have a little bit of civic duty to go to the park, pick up the trash, do it for free. So, please don't do this. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Brian Guthrie, and I live on Bridal Path, which is the neighborhood right across the street from Fort Williams. And I just have a couple of ideas here. I'm sort of on the fence about fees or no fees, but I might have some ideas or just some suggestions that would avoid having a toll booth. I think a toll booth would cause traffic problems. The traffic getting in and out of our neighborhood on a summer, or anytime between 8 and 5 on a summer weekend day is just horrendous, and I think a toll booth would add to that. But you could do something like perhaps an optional fee, and I know that there's an optional box near the headlight, but what I'm suggesting is make signs, tell people we need their help to maintain this beautiful place. That's just one idea. The other thing that I see a lot every night, and I can hear it from my house, I hear the guard. He gives about 4 or 5 warnings to people. The park's closing now. Time to go. And every night, someone doesn't listen, and they inevitably get locked in. And I know that that's taking town resources to go, let them out, etc. I suggest a fine for that. I don't know what the amount would be. But if you want to go home tonight, it's $100. I think those would be ways to start to see if we could bring in some revenue that way. The other alternative would be some sort of a centralized metered parking system. When I lived in Boston, I'd go to a train station and there'd be one centralized box sitting in the parking lot where you would actually pay your meter fee. So that way you wouldn't have to build the infrastructure of having to put a meter in every parking space. And just in my view, it's a little less intrusive than a toll booth. On the other side of use for the park, I echo the sentiments of someone else. I think commercial vehicles that are going in there for profit should in some way have to share that profit. In particular, I see a trolley that comes in about 10 times a day. And that's filled with people who are probably paying, $10 to $15 each. So I think that there should be a use fee there.
Thank you. And everybody's been doing good. Thank you.
There wouldn't be a fine. That's just an overnight lodging fee. I'm Steve Simons, Brentwood Road, Cape Elizabeth. I don't envy you. You have a terrific job before you to balance the budget in a reasonable, affordable, fair way this year. I thought you might like to hear from somebody who was a member of the original Fort Williams Advisory Committee. Not Advisory Committee, it was a study committee. The last one of several, as a matter of fact. That finally, after listening to hundreds of citizens, hearing a number of different proposals, some of them very attractive proposals, some money-making ideas that would be hard to turn down. But the word we heard was leave this Fort Williams open as a park and free without charges, and that is what we recommended to the then council. Where are you, Henry? Henry Adams being on the council at the time. And at the end of the 70s, the council did adopt that philosophy. So having that in the background, I think you have to put me in your no column. Clearly, and by the way, I'd like to echo Bill Lowell's comment about the Councilor Lynch, who did come up with an idea. You're going to have to look at all kinds of ideas to do the job this year. And I commend her and others for that. I looked at the proposal. The finances do look pretty good on this proposal. They appear to cover costs, perhaps more than costs. However, I would urge you, if you're serious about this, to go back again and talk with the former chair and the current chair of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee to make sure that the data is correct. My concern, however, are the hidden costs, the intangible costs, those that are hard to quantify. The first is, and I'll only mention three of these, the first is loss of the free, open access to Fort Williams, of the same kind of access that we have to so many other amenities in other villages and neighbors around us. Those places have been identified, have been mentioned many times. I would find it very, very uncomfortable if the proposal were adopted to go to those places in South Portland, in Scarborough, in Yarmouth, in Brunswick, to use their amenities that are available to us free without charge. The second loss, I think, is something we should contemplate. It is the perception that other towns around us would have of the spirit, our spirit, for cooperation, fairness, and for equity. Those of us and you who have served on area regional commissions and committees, COG, for example, the county commission and committees, water districts, and so on and so on, on and on and on, know how important this perception is when you try to negotiate fair and equitable policies or agreements. And the third, and I might say among those things that have to be negotiated, where we are talking with others, are people concerned about GPA. The third is within ourselves. I think that we lose something in ourselves. I think that we lose the satisfaction that comes with being a contributor to the common good, a contributor to a community and the larger community around us.
Steve, you need to summarize.
If there comes a time when all of the towns around decide that it makes sense to charge a fee, that's a little different. I think it would be a bad idea, and I think we'd be losing the philosophy on which the fort was originally built. Thanks.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, my name is Jack Sears. I live at 24 Waterhouse Court, and I've lived in town for 19 years, and I am the treasurer of the Fort Williams Charitable Foundation, and I am opposed to the fee personally, and I think everybody on our committee is. And I'd like to start by saying that I've given money, donated money, to the Fort Williams Charitable Foundation each of the last couple of years, and I see people on the council who have donated money to the Fort Williams Charitable Foundation, and town officials who have donated money to the Fort Williams Charitable Foundation. I wouldn't have done it if they charged a fee, and I wonder whether any of you would have donated money if they were charging a fee. And I don't think, as Ellie said, I don't think it's realistic to suspect or to expect that you can raise money, get donations, for a place where you're charging a fee. The other thing is, I think this would end up being the only lighthouse in the state of Maine we'd have to pay a fee to get in and see the lighthouse. But I've got a solution for that, a modest proposal we could deal with. I understand there is a budget problem, but what we could do, you see, is we could open up the south road to the lighthouse that goes down next to Delano Park, because we'd have to build a parking lot down there. But then they could get to the lighthouse without being charged. And if we really want to make money, then we could open the north entrance down in front of the Grand Old Mansion and park on, you know, pave over that parking lot and put in Le Grand Maison restaurant there and make some money. We could have a restaurant in town. Some people think that would be nice. The field next to the main entrance where you'd be charging the $5 fee, there's a sign that says no golfing, turn it into a golf. Driving range, $7 a bucket, you'd make money. Believe me, people want to use it that way. Anyway, that's why you've got a sign. There's a berm where they want to build a cliff walk at the south end of the park. It was put up for rifle practice. It can be a rod and gun club again. It's a great place to skeet shoot. We could make some good money there. I'm telling you, I've got a couple of ideas. I'm opposed to the fee, but if you're going to have them, I think you can license it and do a little bit better. Here's a couple of pictures of my 15-year-old's good with Adobe Photoshop. So we dummy up the lighthouse so it looks like a Coca-Cola bottle. Put the Nike swish. If you want to make some money, licensing fees, and do it legitimately and make some serious money. You can charge for the bloke brothers' toilets. How's that for fee for service? Okay. Now there would be some problems. I was happy enough to get a copy of Councilwoman Lynch's letter, and I did appreciate it, and it's a very, very thoughtful letter, and I appreciate her seriousness, and I want to be somewhat humorous. I'm not trying to be cruel or unkind or make fun of her. I take her proposal seriously. But she suggests that, you know, it's $50 for a season pass to Crescent Beach. Well, not quite. It's $50 for a season pass to 30 state parks. Some are at the beach, some are at the lake, some are at rivers, some are at mountains, some are at forests, and you can go to all different ones. And there's something else going on there. They have ample parking. They have bathrooms. They have showers. They have snack bars. You can get a coffee, a soda, an ice cream, a hamburger, a hot dog. You can use a bathroom. We could take care of that. We'd have to ditch in water, sewer, electricity, telephone if we wanted to do that. And guess what else they have? She talks about those parks. 50 parks, $50, that's $1.67 for each park. Do we want to charge $1.67? And they have one other thing we don't have. They have a beach. Scarborough has a beach, Pine Point has a beach that she mentions in the letter. But we could fix that. We haul away all those darn rocks and we truck in some beach sand. Now, I know the shoreland zoning ordinance, it would be a lot and legal fees and stuff involved, but I'm a lawyer, so I can live with that. Okay, but all kidding aside, I think it's a bad idea, and I don't think it should be done, and I think the last thing the town needs to do is to start trying to use the fort as a money-making operation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
My name is Brian Hanson. I live at 4 Brook Road, and I'd like to know why I got picked. Follow that. I am an advocate for charging a fee to Fort William. However, I differ from Marianne's approach. I think we should concentrate on the buses. Last night, as I was listening to the debate, for some reason I thought about 40-some years ago when your predecessors made the decision to spend their Yankee thrift thought to spend $200,000 on this park. And we'll all agree that was a great decision. However, in their Yankee thrift, I wonder how they feel about the $120,000 a year that it costs to maintain the park. Times have changed. I've heard that there are 1 million visitors a year to the park. Hundreds, if not thousands of buses visit the park every year. Patrons paying $20 a head, generating millions of dollars to these bus companies. And what are these bus companies doing for us? I think that they are affecting our historic rural character. How do 40,000-pound buses fit into rural character. Have you ever ridden your bike on Shore Road? 25-pound bike, one bus goes by, you breathe. Two buses, three buses go by. And I think that's quite a cost. The people on the buses, they're here to look and leave. We have no commercial base that benefits from these buses. So in conclusion, I don't think we can afford to consider Fort Williams as our gift to Greater Portland anymore. Based on what we learned last night, our taxes aren't really our taxes. We send them to Augusta, and Augusta might send them back, might not. You as a town council have an opportunity to tax and retain some income. Whatever, I'm not saying you can build a school with it, but I am saying that I need to see some faith. There's been a lot of spending, and there hasn't been a lot of creativity as far as how we're raising this money, so I hope that you'll consider some type of charge at Fort Williams. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Kevin Stack. I live at 24 Brentford Road. One of my neighbors was here, and I disagree with him. We disagree about a lot of things, but he's a good guy. After listening to last night's town council meeting on television, I decided to come here and make a statement. I am in favor of the proposal to charge a $5 seasonal parking fee at Fort Williams. My reasons are as follows. First, there are three parks in Cape Elizabeth: Fort Williams, Crescent Beach State Park, and Two Lights State Park. Crescent Beach and Two Lights already charge fees. To the best of my recollection, they are $5 per day or $50 per season. I see no reason why the state can charge for use of a park in our town, and we cannot. In addition, there is a charge for use of Scarborough Beach, which I believe is $50 per year for non-residents. Second, the proposed parking fee of $5 for an entire season, summer season, that's all summer long. A lot of people seem to think it's $5 every time you go into the park, and it's not. The $5 fee for an entire season would not be a hardship on anyone. Paying $5 to be able to park one's car and enjoy a beautiful park for an entire summer season is a bargain when compared to the cost of taking the family to a baseball game or a movie. Going out for ice cream with the family on a summer's night costs more than $5. Now, I was going to say, you can't get a six-pack of beer for $5, but my wife made me take that out. Third, it costs the town approximately $120,000 per year to maintain the park. The $5 seasonal parking fee for park users will go to park operation and maintenance, relieving the taxpayers of this financial burden. Tax burden in Cape Elizabeth is essentially borne by its residents. Unlike the neighboring city of South Portland, the town of Scarborough, we have no waterfront oil terminal facilities, tank farms, factories, shopping malls, or office parks to tax. We, the homeowners, pay for everything. Let's have the people who use some of our tax-supported facilities help us. Finally, I was taken aback to see a member of this council on television make the statement that this is a wealthy town and we can afford to pay for the park. If we were a wealthy town, we would have been no problem approving the renovations of our school building last night. I and the other residents of this town who work for the Postal Service are not wealthy. My friends and neighbors who teach at Cape Elizabeth schools, South Portland schools, Scarborough schools, and Portland schools are not wealthy. The policemen from Westbrook, South Portland, and Portland who live in this town are not wealthy. Nor are the local carpenters, electricians, plumbers, nurses, and other salaried employees who live here. Most of our retirees are not wealthy. I urge you to approve the proposal to charge a nominal $5 per season parking fee for the park and let the park pay for itself. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Bill Gatchell. I live in Cape Elizabeth and Belfield Road.
and I've lived here almost all my life. Not yet. It's good when you got a prompter. I have a 5-page discussion here, which will take more than 3 minutes, and I'll try and cut it short. First paragraph is, it's a tourist mecca. A park that's open to the world for free, a coastal park that offers incredible views and vistas, a park with picnic recreation facilities, a park with athletic fields, a place like no other, featuring the famous Portland headlight and bunker gun emplacements. This is a national newsletter from National Park Foundation. Across the top are 7 pictures. One of those is not a national park. It's Portland Headlight. Everybody gets to see it if Go Park sends you the newsletter. I would also like to encourage everyone, if they have the opportunity, to go on the website, Cape Elizabeth, click Fort Williams, and go in and find the history of Fort Williams Park. Nancy Masterton wrote a wonderful paper. It's available in the library, and it's also on the internet. And if you read through the paper, everything, every phase of the evolution of Fort Williams Park is property tax. Everything is done with property tax. The citizens of this town paid the property tax, and that money that supports Fort Williams Park is the property tax. Somewhere in the early evolution, when the discussion for low-income housing offered by a city councilor from Portland, the idea was squelched because Cape Elizabeth had no industry to tax base, to support the tax base. Well, guess what? Do you know what Maine's largest industry is? It's not paper, it's not pipeline, it's not oil terminals, deep water harbors, it's tourism. They funnel through the gate at Fort Williams Park. So what I am suggesting is this idea. We, the town citizens and taxpayers of the town, have been buying into an industrial complex, a big corporation. We are shareholders. And now the opportunity is in front of us to begin to receive the reward of our investment. I am opposed to setting fees for the residents of the town of Cape Elizabeth. I think that's an injustice and a travesty. If a gentleman that lives on Kettle Cove, Pond Cove, Elizabeth Park, wants to go to Fort Williams, they can't get there on their feet. They got to go by car or some means of transportation. That means they have to go through the gate in a car. You're going to charge that guy $5? I don't think so. So I suggest town residents be exempt, non-residents pay a fee, and buses and tour groups will be paid or charged a fee. Develop revenues from Maine's number one industry, tourism. And the proceeds should go to the trust, which I knew nothing about until 2 or 3 days ago when I went on the website.
You need to summarize, Bill.
I have summarized, I believe, but there are 3 other issues. Handling traffic, exhaust emissions from the large buses, and the question of whether we have the legal right to charge a fee for people to go to see Portland Headlight. I'm not sure about that. I think that the town manager may have some light on that. So I'll say it one more time. No fee for town residents. Outside of the town, you pay a fee, and develop revenues from tourism. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Dan Fisher. Hi, Henry. I live at 22 Campion Road, Cape Elizabeth. I am a former member of the Fort Williams Commission. from 1995 to 2002. I'm also a former chair of the commission from in 1998 and 1999. And I was very fortunate to be on the commission for two different studies on fees, 1995 and then 1998. Before I get into what I wanted to talk about, I want to reiterate something that Al said earlier. Many of us go under the Fort Williams Commission not knowing what we think about fees, philosophically, logistically, anything like that. And I know of no former chairperson that is in favor of fees, and I know very few former members of the commission that are in favor of fees. And I think you have to go through this process a couple times, which I've done, to understand some of the logistical pieces to it and some of the philosophical pieces to it. Back in 1998, there was a study done, and there was some talks, there was some discussion somewhere along the line about the study. The residents of Cape Elizabeth were given a survey, and the results of the survey were that fees should be charged in Fort Williams. And I'm not sure that's entirely correct, because there were two questions on that ballot. One was, should there be fees for residents? And one, should there be fees for non-residents? Should there be fees for residents? 34 said yes, 495 said no. Non-residents, 320 said yes, 200 said no. If you total those up, the actual figures are 354 said yes to fees, 695 said no to fees. And so, those are the actual questions, and those numbers came from the actual study. Around the same time in 1998, the council charged the commission to do a study as to what could be done at Fort Williams to make Fort Williams self-sustaining. And we went through a year-long study and made a presentation to the commission. That study is a document, I think, that's somewhere in Town Hall. And I think every time that the council asks the commission or the town to take a look at fees in Fort Williams, there are several documents that should be reviewed before that happens. This was probably the largest, most detailed study that had happened. We looked at several areas in Fort Williams as to how to bring money, how to raise money, how to charge fees, what would happen. And I'm going to give a little anecdotal piece of what happened during this process, because I think that besides the fact that some of us are philosophically opposed to fees, there are some logistical problems to charging fees. There were a few of us on a very busy July Saturday afternoon. It was hot. It was in the low 90s. There were many people coming into the fort, and we were doing a short survey which asked two questions. The questions were, how many people are entering and where are you from?
Dan, can you summarize quickly, please?
Yeah, I can. The point to this is that by asking two questions, Betty Crane, Nancy Sears, and I were standing close to the beach parking lot. At times, there were 8, 9, and 10 cars lined up behind us. If we decide to charge fees and we have a kiosk sitting somewhere on that entrance road, you're going to have a logistical traffic problem, I believe, on Shore Road. The second thing, and this is the last piece I really do want to talk about, as soon as you start to make changes to the entrance to Fort Williams, you're going to change the landscape of the entrance to Fort Williams forever. And please, please, as you're thinking about doing this, please think about all of the ramifications for charging fees. Think about all of the things that will happen, both positive and negative, because I think there are a lot of negative aspects to us charging fees at Fort Williams. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, good evening. My name is Ken Johnson. I live on 12 Arrow Point Road. Been a resident for 22 years. I feel pretty strongly that we should not charge fees. I think this park just happens to be in our town, and there's a little bit of stewardship that we just have to keep it open for the rest of the state and rest of the country, really. With that, I'm going to take my tag off, because conceptually, I agree with Mary Ann, and I actually think we have some answers lying right in front of us. It would be great to try to generate more revenue somehow in this town, so we can build our kindergartens and do what we want to do school-wise and town-wise. I look at the gift shop that's there, and I'm a gift shop part owner with my wife Kathy. We own Presence of Heart gift shop on Cottage Road. It's absolutely amazing the numbers that come out of that gift shop. I will ask the town council to look at those numbers, to look at the revenues, to look at the profits, and also look at what it does. I've heard a lot of numbers today. I'm not sure if they're accurate, but there is 1 million visitors, and they do generate $500,000 in sales. That's 50 cents a person. That's that's a lot. On the other hand, and I'll talk about the gift shop for a little bit, as well as it does, there are several times during the year when that gift shop is not open. I know that because I see the buses go by my gift shop and don't stop. And I see them, you know, go, and sometimes we get some people actually complaining that, gee, I wish they had an opportunity to buy a souvenir. I think the gift shop that you have there is absolutely terrific, and I think the revenues could be improved quite a bit if you matched when people go there, and hopefully that's not going to hurt my shop. But the other point I would like to make, and I think this is sort of a model. I don't think the concept of a gift shop was in the original thought process of what should be at Fort Williams. I think probably there's a lot of people who complained about that. I haven't seen anyone complain about the gift shop down there. In fact, I see a lot of happy people. The other thing I know about gift shops, and I know this might sound sexist, but for every woman that's shopping in a gift shop, there's usually a husband outside that doesn't want to go in the gift shop. They would love to buy a cup of coffee or a hot dog or a soda. Really, when you look at it, selling 50 cents more a person, that's just selling one coffee, one bottle of water. I would love to go down and hit some golf balls down there. That was a good idea for me. But that, you know, that's, you know, a little bit extreme. I think from what the gift shop that we have to what was sort of the ultimate revenue source that was jokingly presented, there's something, I don't even want to say in between, very, very close to the gift shop, adding one more little thing that I think would produce a lot of revenue. I happen to live over near that area, and every week in the summer, my boys come to me and say, we're going to ride our bike to Red's and get an ice cream. We're going to ride our bike to South Portland House of Pizza or the Cookie Jar. I asked them tonight, I said, would you rather ride your bike to Fort Williams and get an ice cream there? And they looked at me like, sure we would. Why? We don't want to ride to Red's. We're going to sit on the curbstone. It sort of stinks.
Yeah, you need to finish up here.
So I guess my concept is that we don't want driving ranges and all those skeet shooting. I think there's something very, very, a slight addition to the concept of the gift shop that would solve a lot of issues.
Thank you.
Hi. My name is Sue Pierce. I live on Hunts Point Road, and I support the fees of Fort Williams. I wish this option did not have to be considered, but it is clear to me that the citizens of Cape Elizabeth cannot afford to continue to support this park on our own. We are facing a serious financial situation. Councillor Carson, last night you spoke about the impending war, the high cost of electricity, gas. We heard how long-time residents on fixed income cannot continue to face increases in property tax. I understand how residents are concerned about traffic problems. I also understand why people want to keep this park free to the thousands that visit it each year. But I do not feel that we can ignore the fact that the projected annual net income of $200,000 would not only cover the $120,000 in yearly park expenses, but would generate $80,000 in income to offset some of the increasing expenses our town will be facing in the years to come. I know that the people here tonight and the emails that you received only represent a small percent of our town's population. Since we are facing a decision that would generate significant revenue for our town in these difficult times, I feel all citizens should be heard from. To that extent, I think that this proposal should be sent to referendum. Thank you.
Hi, my name is B.J. Nicholson. I live at 243 Mitchell Road, and I'm here to speak in favor of fees. I don't necessarily think that I'm in favor of charging residents a fee for access, but if it came right down to it, if the council or the town decided to charge residents a $5 fee for entry, then I'd probably gladly pay it. But I do think it's very important that the town seriously consider a fee for all bus access, all commercial access, for companies that are conducting tours of the Southern Maine area and who have the Portland Headlight as a stop on that tour. I think it's perfectly reasonable. I think it's something that the town should have done a long time ago. These companies do make money from these tours. Everyone who comes to Southern Maine wants to see the lighthouse. I know that they pay money to be on these tours, and I'm sure that they think that as part of that money they're paying on the tour, they're paying a fee to see the lighthouse. I think it's a perfectly reasonable suggestion. And I also think that the town has put a lot of money and a lot of time and a lot of effort into improving Fort Williams, and after a certain point in time, the town needs to examine the amount of money they're spending on the park as opposed to the amount of money that they could be realizing through fees for commercial use. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Maya Cohen, and I feel like I live at Ground Zero.
Kind of pull it down a little.
I live 21 Surf Road. My dining room and my kitchen both look at the Goddard Mansion, and if there were a driving range, I would be looking at the driving range. I'm here to oppose fees to Fort Williams, and my major concern with an imposed fee to the park is, of course, increased traffic that many people have mentioned, and in our small community, neighborhood community, where we have no sidewalks and we have narrow streets, that perhaps the natural flow of vehicles would be to park in the neighborhood in Oakhurst or Sherwood Forest or in Cape Cottage area so that they could walk on foot to go to the park. And I don't think that's right, and I think that our quality of life, having to deal with traffic from the park, would be terrible. And so, as a neighborhood, I'm very concerned with the amount of traffic that we would see from potential turnarounds from people trying to not pay a fee. The second thing that I'm very concerned about, and I think it's something you need to consider, is that what Ms. Ellie Baker said earlier in fundraising. I'm a volunteer fundraiser for some charities here in town. And if the town has given the commission or the foundation a charge to be self-sufficient and they haven't shown it, they haven't had enough time, I do think it's unfair that you impose a fee and basically take them out of the knees. As far as the ability to raise any money through fundraising efforts, it's very, very difficult. It's difficult enough as it is in an environment now with economy, impending war, and what have you. So I would like to state again that I am against imposing a fee in any golf range at Fort Williams. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ellen Nadeau, and I live at 9 Apple Tree Lane. And I'm here to speak for a citizen who is not here, but before I say that, I would just like to add my own voice by saying that I object to having a fee. And I just want to say that we moved here 4 years ago, or nearly five, and our first volunteer project was joining the Fort Williams Centennial Celebration Committee. What an exciting way to become introduced to the community of Cape Elizabeth. And I developed a passion for the fort, and I would be crushed if I could not go there, as I would feel on any given day to breeze in and breeze out. So please, let's not do that. But I'd like to read this letter from Mr. Joel Russ, 28 Rocky Hill Road. It's addressed to Mr. Roberts and the council. And it reads, I'm sorry I will not be able to attend this evening's work session on the proposal to impose fees for admission to Fort Williams Park, but did want to share with you my thoughts as a longtime Cape Elizabeth resident. About 25 years ago, I was executive director of Greater Portland Landmarks, a private nonprofit organization dedicated to the preservation of our region's rich architectural heritage. A plan I supported to create affordable housing using the buildings of Officers Row was not chosen. I've reflected on that unsuccessful effort many times since and have come to the conclusion that the decision the town of Cape Elizabeth made to maintain Fort Williams as a passive recreation area for all the people of Greater Portland was the right one. Each time I walk, run, drive, attend events, or picnic at Fort Williams Park, I'm reminded of and thankful for the foresight and long-term vision of the town councilors who made that decision and of the public which has continued to support that decision over the years. I've also reflected on the joy that so many people of all ages experience on a regular basis, from the simplest activities such as swinging on the swing set, flying kites, slowly strolling the shore walk and quietly sitting on the donated benches, to the more robust community events such as the Pops Concerts, Family Fun Day, the annual art show, and the Beach to Beacon Road Race. What a wonderful contribution Cape Elizabeth has made to the lives and the quality of life of the people in the greater Portland community. I'm proud of this town's commitment to the recreational life of this area and hope its generosity will continue. Think how different this region would be if public access were limited through the imposition of fees at places such as Mackworth Island, Back Cove, the Shore Walk at Seven Main Technical College, the 4th Street Sanctuary, Gilsland Farm, and Deering Oaks. I would not want the town of Cape Elizabeth to set a trend for short-term financial reasons that was embraced by other communities facing similar financial challenges. If we begin to impose restrictions on the free access we now take for granted, we are sure to regret the loss of a special benefit of living in this greater Portland community. I encourage you to continue this town's historical commitment to free access to Fort Williams Park for the benefit of the people of the greater Portland. Respectfully submitted, Joel Russ.
Thank you.
My name is Jeff Keneally. I live at 16 Highview Road. I am opposed to fees for Fort Williams Park, and I think you've heard more reasons than I could try to cover, so I won't try to repeat anything. I think that fees and the administration of fees would forever change the character of the park in a way that none of us who live here really want to see. If you can't conceive of that, then I can't say anything more that would help you. What I do want to say is there are some alternatives that I think we should look at. There is the Fort Williams Charitable Foundation, and someone ahead of me, well ahead of me tonight, mentioned the Friend of the Fort program. We have just begun a Friend of the Fort program, and in fact, you can log on to fortwilliams.org on the internet. You can make a donation online to Fort Williams Charitable Foundation, and you can become a Friend of the Fort formally by making a donation of $50. So that program now is in existence, and we invite you all to log in and make a donation that way. So I would like to see the Charitable Foundation given the opportunity to develop more and more ways for fundraising to take care of the building up the funds we need to maintain and improve the park. But I am on the board for the foundation, so I do have, you know, an interest in trying to keep that rolling. The second thing I think we should look at as alternatives has been mentioned once or twice already, is the gift shop. The gift shop, I don't know the current numbers, Mike, you know them. Last I knew it was grossing over $500,000 a year, netting something like $300,000 per year. Now I know from being in the park frequently myself, my wife goes in the park frequently herself, in the middle of the summer, there are people who cannot get into that gift shop, it's too crowded. We could raise more money by expanding that gift shop. Expansion of that gift shop, both in terms of space and hours, is something we should look at very carefully in terms of raising money. And I think that the gentleman who shot a time ago presented the idea that the men wait outside. I know one of the reasons that we don't sell refreshments in the park is the trash problem, the litter problem. We have carry-in, carry-out process. However, when those buses unload men and women, they don't go very far from that location. If we just sold bottled water, or perhaps soft drinks to the men, standing outside. You'd be surprised how much money that would raise. So I really want to suggest that we, you the council, we the foundation, and the Lighthouse 501c3, look at the other opportunities besides raising fees. So on the foundation, we've given you the opportunity to go online right now and make a donation. Secure, it's a secure site for making a donation with your credit card. You can also send us a check, of course. But I really would like to see us look very carefully at the gift shop being expanded both in terms of space and hours, and partly into the other seasons too, because there are many times, someone's mentioned already, that there are lots of buses, lots of people there in the fall, and the gift shop's closed many hours. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ed Nadeau, and I live at 9 Apple Tree Lane. My wife spoke a moment ago on someone else's behalf, but basically we'd like to express our concern regarding the proposal to institute a fee at Fort Williams. First of all, when one buys or builds a home in Cape Elizabeth, you pay a premium for that privilege. Now, granted, the fort is one of those things that justifies such a premium. And to my mind, what those of us who don't live on Shore Road or along the shore, that's our unfettered access to the ocean. And it's our feeling that you'd be denying us easy access to that resource that essentially we all bought into. If I understood Mr. Barkerman correctly a little while ago, he mentioned his figure is that 0.5% of the town's revenue goes to support the fort. And I couldn't help but draw the comparison to foreign aid, the federal budget. Everybody thinks foreign aid is such a huge expense. And you think, and when you really look at the federal budget, it's 1%. And you think of the benefits of foreign aid and the grand scheme. We have our own little opportunity here, not on foreign aid, on a slightly smaller scale, but people from all around the world, all around the state, everywhere, come to enjoy this resource. And I think it's a small contribution to the region, and not only to our own well-being, but for all the other amenities that many other people had mentioned. Just the comparison was just struck me as I was sitting here that we do have an opportunity to be part of a bigger world than the 9,000 people that live here. My other great concern, if a fee, as it's currently formulated, is imposed, that and someone else had mentioned this too, that people's expectations rise once you pay a fee. So now what do you have? You have customers. Customers, will make demands. Who's going to respond to these customers' questions, their requests? When someone shows up and say, oh, that's $5, please. Well, don't I get a map? Don't I get some form of printed material? Do I get a piece on the history of the fort? What am I getting for this $5? So I just feel that you're opening a small store without providing any tangible goods. I know there's many attorneys in town, there's attorneys on the board. Does this create a liability issue? Would we then need a lifeguard? Would we then need other services that may be required? The cost model, and I have to say, I haven't actually seen anything that I would characterize as a cost model. And I don't know if any of these other unforeseen expenses have been taken into consideration, but I really think before anyone can wholeheartedly endorse this proposal as it's currently formulated, we need much more detail, because many people have discussed other issues here in terms of turnaround space, backups of lines, and that sort of thing. And without dwelling on the economic issues, which many people have brought up, and this is reminiscent. This model is reminiscent of Bart Harbor. They charged $5, some number of years ago, really not that long ago. They decided to charge $5 for the 20-mile loop road. Well, it wasn't too many years after. It went to 10. Guess what the National Park Service did yesterday? It's going to be 20 this year. So my fear is that once this revenue stream starts, it's going to become irresistible to bump this fee. And on the surface, $5 sounds nominal, and but you pay in so many other ways.
You need to summarize.
Okay. I guess I'll summarize. You pay in many other ways. Your time, your patience, sitting in this queue to get to the fort. I'd never pass up an opportunity. At least make the loop through there. And I just think it would be doing all of us a disservice to turn this into a profit center with a proposal as it's currently formulated. It just wouldn't be appropriate.
Thank you.
Please consider all those other things I mentioned.
Mr.
Mr. Chairman, may I ask for clarification of the gift shop revenues from the town manager before we go forward? Because a number of people have talked about that, and I think it would be important for the public to have some clarification of that. And I'm sure that the remaining speakers won't mind if we take a couple of minutes.
Mike, you want to?
Also, maybe mention the restrictions on that also.
Yes, the restrictions. That's why I'm asking for that clarification while people are still here. And so we all have the same understanding.
Look at that. Talk about being prepared.
Thank you, Gene.
This is Gene Gross, by the way, who is the museum director at the Museum of World Headlines.
Good job.
Thank you. The gift shop at Portland Headlight first opened back in what we call fiscal year 1992. Since then, it's had sales of $3,786,235 as of the end of last month. All of those monies, as well as museum admissions and donations, go into a separate fund that is strictly dedicated to the museum at Portland Headlight. It's operated by a totally separate board of directors. Not totally separate, the directors are the members of the capables of a town council, but when they're sitting as directors or trustees of that separate corporation, they need to act in the best interest of that corporation. The lighthouse was given to the town for non-profit purposes, not to make a profit. The articles of incorporation for the lighthouse provide that the money needs to go back into Portland Headlight or the surrounding property or within Fort Williams if it relates back to the lighthouse property. To that end, the trustees of Portland Headlight have approved a number of projects over the year, but the main one, the chief one, has been the reconstruction that you see of Battery Blair, which is the former gun emplacement right as you go down the hill before you turn left to go to the lighthouse. That was all redone, as well as the new paths all around the lighthouse. That project was a little over $170,000. There was also a small payment that was made towards the cliff walk that extends to Portland Headlight, in addition to the major donation that was made by the barbers for that purpose. In addition to the amount I mentioned of gross sales, Gene's policy is to double the price of any good that we buy wholesale before we do it retail. So one of the major costs is you can divide that amount in half because of the cost of goods. We also have payroll costs, we have heating costs, utility costs, the taking care of the lighthouse property itself, the burglar alarm, all of those different things. That adds up. As of June 30, 2002, the Portland Headlight Fund had a $301,778 fund balance. That included $214,000 in undesignated fund balance and about $86,000 that was inventory in the gift shop. Portland Headlight now, one of the major expenses has been retirement of the debt for the lighthouse. The development cost of the museum when the town purchased the property was a little over $700,000. Some of that was donated by citizens and others. The town borrowed $285,000 for the lighthouse, and the town general fund also provided an unsecured loan to the lighthouse of, I think it was about $140,000. All of that money, including the debt effective this year, has been repaid, so the lighthouse is debt-free. Right now, in the proposed budget for next year, the profit, I believe, is about $40,000, the projected net profit. Obviously, you know, with some of the suggestions we've heard this evening, you know, those issues can always be looked at. But again, those proceeds would help to ensure that the lighthouse is maintained to the quality that the community would like to present that, as well as some related activities within Fort Williams Park. Did that answer your question, Marianne?
Yes, thank you.
I ask one question. Where does this money that, if we have this fee, since it goes, I mentioned it, goes into the general fund. Now, when it gets into the general fund, Is that money divided, or is it earmarked for what the proposal is?
We'll answer that after the question. I don't want this to become exchange back and forth, so we're going to get the speakers.
Excuse me. One more question that went to the manager was the question so that people would know when we're talking about the gift shop on the ability or lack of ability to expand the size of the gift shop because of the zoning.
Yeah.
It's just, they might explain that.
In terms of physical space, the lighthouse cannot be expanded, nor the gift shop, because of the shoreland zoning regulations that the state has imposed on something that's that close to the water. Obviously, there could be other expansions in terms of ancillary facilities elsewhere, but anyone that's been in that lighthouse knows that the folks that volunteer there and work there absolutely maximize the space in terms of the amounts that are for sale in there and the customers in there at any given point. But we do look from time to time at expanding the hours, and we'll continue to look at that.
Thank you. We could continue with the speakers. Elaine?
Thank you. My name is Elaine Maloney. I live at 19 Stonegate Road. I've lived in town for 15 years. My husband and I have sent you all an email regarding our feelings on charging at Fort William, so I'll not go through the details of our reasoning again. But do let me say that we both support the idea that this town must look for new sources of revenues or creative ways to allow retired homeowners on fixed incomes the ability to remain in town. I encourage you not only to look at revenues, but also to look at these creative ways, such as some of the programs that some towns are looking to lessen the tax impact on retired citizens, such as delaying of property tax increases until the home is sold. I kind of like some of the ideas I heard tonight. I'm not necessarily tied to a kiosk where we collect a fee. I like the idea that we would charge more for buses. I think there's a lot of potential there. I like the idea of the gift shop being open for a longer period. I have two teenage daughters who will work for minimum wage and would love to have a job at the gift shop. But regardless, the signs all point to the fact that we must do things differently than we have in the past. Like it or not, this community, through our town council, supports open space preservation and minimal commercial presence that has ultimately led to a narrow tax base that channels all tax increases to the property owner. It is as much a responsibility of the town council as our state to look for ways to not underfund needed services at the expense of trying to minimize property tax increases. The schools are struggling with maintaining programs while losing close to $1 million in general purpose aid from the state over the last 2 years. The schools wrestle with absorbing these decreases while demands for a 0 to 3% net to tax increase are virtually impossible without negatively impacting education of our children. Their opportunity to create revenues is, the school board's opportunity to create revenues, as you know, is virtually non-existent. We must look at both the municipal and the school budget as one. Why should the schools take a hit from the state equaling a 2-year 37% decrease in GPA when the town can separate the double-digit increase that you have in county assessment from your operating increases because it is, quote, beyond your control? I argue that the state's GPA allotment to CAPE is beyond the control of our school board and ask the council members to remember that we are a one-town concept working together to provide services and to manage our monies. Last night I heard concerns from your councilors that range from pending war to concerns for helping people on fixed incomes remain in their homes. These concerns, along with their need to delve deeper into the details of the school proposed projects, led them to delay action on our proposals. It is these very same concerns that should lead them towards making a decision to increase the revenues from Fort Williams. I also happen to think they should also reconsider on taking the lowest price bid at this time on various projects that come before the town. I argue that we still offer Two Lights and Crescent Beach to surrounding communities because these entities are not taxed, and they don't even help the town's tax base while we continue to offer the services to support their public access. Take the state parks out, and we will still offer Greenbelt Access, Kettle Cove, Robinson Park, the Poor Farm, to any and all.
Hey, Lynn, you need to tie it up.
Okay. Citizens, both retired and younger, value their services, and while some are willing to pay more in taxes, others are not. This leads me to believe that if the town council and school board tries to maintain services, then we must look to create the revenues, and Fort Williams is one of them. Do any of us like it? No, probably not. Would I rather cut programs to the tune of $200,000 to continue to maintain Fort Williams? Probably not. But given the lesser of two evils, I opt for creating revenues from Fort Williams. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. My name is Susan Spagnola, and I live at 2 Heatherstone Lane, right near the entrance to Fort Williams, and I am a supporter of the proposal to charge entry fees to Fort Williams. As a resident of this community, I feel blessed to have such a wonderful natural asset close at hand. I frequently walk my dog in Fort Williams. In the summer, the park is always abuzz with activity, frisbee games, family barbecues, kite flying, people swimming, biking, and running, and buses streaming in to visit the lighthouse. Our park is a destination for members of nearby communities and tourists who choose to take advantage of this invaluable natural resource. And we residents bear the entire $120,000 financial burden, and we have no choice. Given current economic conditions and the threat to our municipal and school services because of lower state funding, why not charge all beneficiaries of our park a nominal fee? This would allow us to make up some of the state funding gap. Would free access to Fort Williams be ideal? Absolutely yes. But it is not a free park that attracts families or individuals to live in our community, but rather the quality of our school and municipal services. Are there alternative sources of revenue to the community? At present, aside from increasing taxes, it appears no. I understand that it is the goal of the Fort Williams Foundation to ultimately pay for the park, but given the economy and the number of nonprofit organizations that are looking to our residents for financial support, it may take years to raise the funds necessary to cover this annual $120,000 cost. Finally, I would argue that by charging fees to Fort Williams, we are not closing our doors to members of nearby communities, but rather admitting to them that even affluent Cape Elizabeth is being forced to make difficult choices, and showing them that we place a priority on the quality of the educational and municipal services provided to our residents. Thank you.
Thank you. For the next speaker, I would say each person only has one opportunity to speak. We don't want people coming up several times, Jack.
Paul's been gracious enough. I just want to correct something that was said about the zoning. I'm on the zoning board, too. There is a provision in shoreline zoning for some expansion of non-conforming properties. So an application can be made to the zoning board for the expansion.
We can.
Of the shop, and this provision's brought up.
We'll look at that then. Thank you.
Good evening. Excuse me. My name is Paul Phillips. I live at 8 Little Jot Road. I was a member of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission from 1997 till last December. I was chair of that for 3 years. You know, I had this big, beautiful speech, and I scrapped it all because everybody said a lot of what I said. And the Portland Press Herald was nice enough to print my notes a couple weeks ago. I heard a lot this evening about feeling. Things feel. It's so nice to make a decision without really studying an issue. And when I joined the Fort Williams Committee back in 97, I had a lot of great ideas too. But then the hard part comes, and you have to study an issue. And this council has done a very good job of getting good qualified people on the commission, a variety of backgrounds, a variety of attitudes. And when you really study an issue, you come to a determination. And that's what the Fort Williams Advisory Commission gives to the council, not just the way I feel, but this is what we really think. And I wanted to just cite an example about having the toll booth, and I probably not a lot of people read the minutes of the Fort Williams meetings. I have them all going back 6 years. If you put a toll booth in, just from a logistics standpoint, you need 3 lanes. You have 1 lane for people that have the pass. You have a lane for people that don't have the pass that want to purchase a pass. Then you'll need a lane for leaving. Now, the people that don't have a pass, some of them will decide they don't want to pay the $5. So now you'll need a turnaround somewhere in that vicinity, as well as the exit. You'll have to have employees. I don't think you'll get a lot of volunteers, as good as the people are of this town, and we have hundreds of volunteers that spend thousands of hours
all over the town, especially Fort Williams. You're not going to get a volunteer to Manitoba and have to explain to all those visitors that's $5 to take a picture of the lighthouse. You'll have to increase the police presence, because as the traffic backs up, and it will back up, as the study that we did back in 98 will, you'll have traffic backed all the way up onto Shore Road, onto my block, onto Cape Cottage, Delano Park. There's no question it will back up, so now you need to be able to control that and control the traffic, so there's employee costs involved. What about people that want to go to day one, or soccer, or t-ball? You go in there in June and you're charging people. You now have to have a way to distinguish people coming from out of town for soccer. You're going to charge those people $5 a hit to come in. Or even our own kids, when you, and I live right across the street, I can see the car screaming in at 5:45 every summer night, spring night, going to T-ball. You need to have someone looking for that. On that issue, there was also a question that was brought up about veterans. I was under the understanding that veterans will always have access both to the memorial that we put a lot of hours into building and to the lighthouse. Well, if a veteran shows up and doesn't have his $5, are you going to turn him away? So the logistics are really a very important issue. What I would finish with on that issue is, if you're going to go ahead and do this, I would insist on hiring an engineering firm for a traffic study. We're just lay people. We just go out there and poll, and we study the issue as well as we can. But we don't really know. So the figure that's been around of $200,000, that is so unrealistic. There's a lot of costs that are really involved. When this proposal first was announced, some of the council members, it was a question as to whether the funds stayed in the park, which some councilors were in favor of it, or whether they went to the general fund. And I just want to make that distinguishing of difference, that there are some people that if the funds stayed inside the park, then that's one thing. But if you're doing it just for a revenue source, there's probably an Indian tribe that would love that park to put a casino there. I mean, you can really raise a lot of money. Over to the gift shop, I heard a lot about buses, too, that buses are a drag and we should...
You need to summarize.
What's that?
You need to summarize it.
Okay. Let me just read what Cheryl Parker had said at one of our meetings back in 1998. Cheryl said... I need my glasses. The buses do not have a major impact on the gift shop. She expressed concern that fees for tour buses would cause tour operators to avoid Fort Williams. If that were to happen, the gift shop and museum revenues would obviously suffer. We had two people at that meeting from the Visitors Bureau. The buses will not pay to come in. They'll just stop. And when they stop, some people may like that, but the gift shop revenues will go down. Finally, I just want to thank all the volunteers in the fort over the years for the centennial. We've had hundreds of people, thousands of hours. The people that are really involved with the fort, that know it and love it, are almost all against this. Please rely on the people that have spent a lot of their hard-earned hours and do what the studies have shown, and not just what I feel or someone else feels. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Don Haggett. I'm the director of sales for Lafayette Hotels. We own and operate 18 hotels in Maine and New Hampshire. My job is to sell and bring bus tours to Maine. I've been doing it for 30 years. Tonight, I'd like to talk about bus tours. I work for the Golden Goose. We are the industry that everybody is turning to now to solve their tax problem. The city of Portland, I understand, now wants 5% more on the room tax. You talk about the state, they want 3% more. So we're going to go from 7% food and lodging. If everything goes well in Portland, it will be 15%. I want to talk to you about Kennebunkport, because I have spent 2 years trying to tell people that the attitude and the way people are treated in Kennebunkport is not the way it is in the whole state of Maine. I go to NTA and ABA. These are major conventions of tour operators. 8,000 people per year go to these. I spend half of my 7-minute appointment apologizing for the way that they treat buses down in Kennebunkport. Do you realize that if you want to bring a tour to Kennebunkport, you have to pay, I don't know, it's a $50 drop-off fee? That would be like the Maine Mall saying, I'm going to charge $50 that bus so you can bring people to our stores to spend their money. This is outrageous, and it's really affecting the tour operators. We have worked very diligently to try to overcome that. One of the things that I want to address tonight is, please, if you do decide to do this, do some thought. Don't go out and just lambaste the tour operators. Give us, the salespeople, the time to let them know that it's doing. When you say it's $40 a bus, there's one company in Portland called the Main Tour Connection that runs hundreds of buses. It's going to cost them $20,000 or more to bring those buses at $40 a bus. And these are not going to come in on the same bus, by the way. These are tours from all over the country. So it's something that you need to keep in mind. That's going to hurt the industry very badly. One thing that I did, I called my 24 largest tour operators before I came here. And I asked them, I told them what was going on. And I asked them, I said, now, where are you visiting in the state of Maine? What parks do you go to? Not one park other than Acadia. They don't go to Popham. They don't go to Reed State. They don't go to Mount Batty. They don't go to Pemaquid. They don't go to Baxter. They go to none of these. They get all the scenery they need driving up Route 1, going down to Bailey's Island, or driving up, doing the tour of Kennebunkport. By the way, most of my buses have pulled out of Kennebunkport. They now drop their people off in Ogunquit because they feel it's a friendlier city. We just bought 3 hotels in Ogunquit, so that's a one good thing out of all of this. But just again, look at tourism. Tourism is important. It's a major part of the state's income stream. Without tourism, your jobs would be much harder. The revenue that we're deriving from tourism is funding much of the school education that you do. Give us time, give us the tools. If you need to do it, we'll be there, we'll be able to justify it, we'll support it. But please, give us the time. Don't just jump it on us all at once. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jean Gross, the director of the Museum of Portland Headlights. I just wanted to say a few things about how the entrance fees might affect the business portion of the gift shop and museum. Many people, when they learn that there's a charge to come into Fort Williams, they will perceive that as a charge just to look at the lighthouse. And we know from the museum that many people walk up to the door of the museum. There's a little ramp. They walk up. On the side there, on the right-hand side, says admission, $2. 50% of people turn around and go back down the ramp. This might happen with entrance fees, too, especially for the people who just come once a year. The next part I'd like to talk about is the volunteers. Volunteers feel very strongly that the entrance fees should stay open without entrance fees. And several of them have suggested that if there were entrance fees, they would quit. And if there are entrance fees, perhaps staff at the museum and gift shop should be paid staff. Why should they work for free if there's fees being collected? The next thing I'd like to talk about are the buses. In September and October, 75 to 80% of our business comes from bus tours. Last August, Kennebunkport placed a $35 drop-off charge on the buses. So we called up Dock Square businesses, 5 of them, in Kennebunkport, and asked them what the effect of the charge was on their business. One closed, and others filed lawsuits against the loss of business. And what it is, then I called the Chamber of Commerce and asked them if they had any statistics on the loss of business. They didn't, but they said there were a lot of problems with the bus companies. And what it is, some of these bus companies are small, independent companies that price their tours very tightly. So when they go to a place and they learn there's a charge, they can't afford it, they can't absorb it. So they turn around and they leave. So they eventually stop going to Kennebunkport altogether. Well, those very same tours come to Portland Headlight, and I'm afraid we would lose business if those same buses have to turn around and leave. But it not only affects the gift shop and the museum. If we lose buses, that means there's one less bus that goes to Captain Newitt's, and there might be one less bus that stays at the Hampton Inn by the mall. It's a trickle-down effect and affects tourism very deeply. And right now, the museum and gift shop are one of the very few successful, self-supporting lighthouse museum operations in the United States. And I'd hate to see anything change that.
Excuse me, could I just ask a factual question for clarification? You talked about the drop-off fee for buses in Kennebunkport.
Yes.
Was that per trip or per season?
Well, they also registered them. They would only allow a certain amount, I think 3 per hour to come in.
Right, so how much was the fee? How much was
$35.
$35 for per time they wanted to go into Kennebunkport.
Yes.
So it was per visit.
Right, but the larger bus companies maybe can absorb some of that fee, like here in Fort Williams, but the smaller ones won't. And we have many small independent companies.
I understand. I just wanted to make sure it was whether it was $35 per visit or $35 per season.
If I might on that issue, I think the real issue is how many different buses. I know the Gene brings in whatever that trolley comes in all the time.
But that comes in four times a day.
Four times a day. But how many different buses come in as opposed to the same bus over and over?
The larger companies bring all people from the cruise ships, so they come over and over again.
Okay.
But we have many, many small lines that come from all over, you know, Oklahoma, Kansas.
So they come like once a season?
Yes, once a season.
Okay. So we have sort of a mixture there. A bunch that come once a season, and then there are ones like the trolley and the cruise line buses that come mm-hmm. over and over and over again.
Yeah, many summer. Times.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Sorry,
I didn't mean to interrupt. I missed what you said about the percentage of the GISOP sales that were
in
for buses.
September and October, and this includes the cruise ships because they come by bus. It's 75 to 80% of our business comes from bus stores.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jane.
Just if I might, Jack, to put that in perspective, last year that was 192,000 worth of sales during those 2 months.
Okay, thank you.
2 months.
I'm Robert Howe. I live at 9 Steeplebush Road. Prior to that, I lived for 17 years on High Bluff Road over in the Oakhurst area. And I want to back up this whole conversation because very often I hear it revolving around what it will do to the gift shop, what it will do for the bus tours. This is really about proper stewardship of that property. That property existed, the formation of Fort Williams existed long before there was a gift shop, long before there was a museum. And we all pay a fee now to use it. It happens to come out of my property tax. I don't pay it at the door, but I do pay one. So I think you got to broaden your perspective on this. It is, you're focusing on the little pieces and parts. And what you need to focus on is this the proper and the right thing to do for a hunk of land that is promoted not only by this town, but by the regions, by the community, by the Chamber of Commerce. It shows up in magazines, it shows up in calendars. And what we are doing here is giving something to the larger community for their benefit, for our benefit. I'm a little hurt that I personally feel taken by the larger group. I don't think it's just that we depend upon the citizens of Cape Elizabeth to support the activities or support a facility like that without the expectations that all who use it also contribute to it. So I support some type of fee structure. I supported it 17 years ago, and I still do. I think it's the right thing to do. I think you're mismanaging your assets unless you are concerned, unless you deal with that issue, and to just open it up for the benefit of a larger community, while it's laudable, while this is very magnanimous of us all, I think you're hurting the perception of the town and how you treat that property. It's an issue of stewardship. It's the way to manage property and manage your asset. You have a gem there, and it's slowly getting tarnished by a gift store. We've heard we could expand the gift store. Good gracious me, I need another gift store. You know, I want to go to another shopping place, another mall. I don't want to do that. I don't think that's culturally where we're headed. Well, let me say, reading from Las Vegas, yes, we are culturally headed. We are headed that way. We don't need to do that at Fort Williams. What we need to do is understand that this is a lot more complex than it was 25 years ago, that we have a responsibility to ourselves and to the community at large. And it may require looking at that state, not as a profit center, but as a way to generate some revenue to take care of itself.
Thank you.
Betty Crane, I live on Wavin Road. I want to thank the council for having this open forum. I know you had a very late night last night, and I really appreciate your dedication. Obviously, I'm opposed to having fees for many, many reasons, and I'm not going to go into them all because I think they've all been addressed so far tonight. I think the fee proposal leaves a lot of loopholes. I'm afraid it hasn't been thought through thoroughly as far as the consequences of a fee goes. I do appreciate Councilwoman Lynch's care for the taxpayers, because I am a taxpayer, and I really do appreciate her thoughts on this. I know she tries very hard as the finance chairman. But what I would like to say tonight, what I'd like to address, which hasn't been addressed so far, I don't think it's maybe by Mia, I was on the commission for 6 years, and I got to know what goes on in the park quite thoroughly. There are many, many events every single summer, spring and fall, in the park, many more than the average citizen is realizing. And these events are going to cause a problem with how do we handle them? What's going to happen with the Are we going to ask those runners who come from all over the world to pay to park their car?
Of course not.
Of course not. But someone's going to have to handle this. This is going to be a complicated thing. What about the Portland Symphony concert? Are we going to ask another $5 on top of the fee that they already paid to come to it? How about the art show? Are we going to charge the artists? How about Family Fun Day? There are people that come to that that only come once a year. But the Beach to Beacon, to me, is the most important. Do you realize that there are many, many volunteers that do not live anywhere near Cape Elizabeth? Mia told me tonight, maybe she said it, I was in the back of the room when she was speaking, that there are a group that came from Seattle last year. Are they going to have to pay to volunteer at the Beach to Beacon? It's all these things, complications that have not been addressed on this, aside from the traffic problems and the neighborhood problems and all of that. At any rate, how about the shelter? A year or two ago, my husband and I had a family reunion. Everybody, except our one son who lives here in the state of Maine, all 45 members of the Crane family reunion came from out of state. We had a picnic in the shelter. I paid for the shelter. But we also had 9 cars come in. What about the people who have a wedding rehearsal or something in the shelter? They paid either $75 or $150 for the shelter. Are they going to expect their guests to have to pay, these guests that only come this one time to the park? I think we really have to think of all these things. These considerations, on top of the philosophical and logistic problems, have convinced me even more so. I've been opposed to fees for a long time, ever since we did the studies when I was on the commission. But now I'm thoroughly convinced it's a very bad idea for the town. It does cost us money to run the park. It costs us $120,000. That is a highly publicized figure. We all know that. But as Al Barkerman pointed out, what is that in the overall budget? It's 0.5%.
Betty, you need to tie it up.
Okay. We can have a free and open park. We can have good schools. We can have public services. We're a smart people here in Cape Elizabeth. We can get together. We can do this. We can buckle our belts in a little tighter, give up something, bite the bullet, and pay the taxes so we can live in this beautiful community. Thank you.
Thank you.
Harry Hardy, 6 Charles Road. And I'm the guy that goes around and kicks her out at night. So I spend, you know, whatever you decide to do, it's your decision. I spend 40 hours a week in there from April through October. And I agree very much with Mr. Phillips, what he had to say. I think he was right on target in almost everything. And think you've got to, a lot of details to deal with, and I really think you're going to open up a can of worms. You better be ready to deal with details, and I think to assume that you're going to be able to do that with the amount of help you have now is wrong. For example, at Two Lights, now they charge at Two Lights. Of course, they have much better toilet facilities than we have with their outhouses. My response to people up to this point, when they complain about the toilet facility, I tell them it goes with the price of admission. But I don't want to tell them, if we charge. And, you know, there's just so many things. And I'm the guy that's going to have to deal with a lot of these people that have paid $5.
Yeah.
And, you know, any wrath that's to be taken out of the town is going to be taken out on me, so I hope you'll consider increasing my take, because Mike can tell you I work for a very nominal fee. I work there as much because I love the place as I do because, you know, I can make money at it. It's a way to do both. But before you start charging a fee, make sure you get your ducks in a row, because I don't think we do.
Thank you. Please, let's not be applauding or booing.
Hi there. My name is Steve Lyons with the State of Maine Office of Tourism. My primary responsibility, or one of them, is to work with the motor coach market that brings all the bus tours into the state. And I'm not here to oppose or support the ordinance. I'm just here to sort of explain a little bit briefly how some of the motor coach market works, so that, you know, in case some folks don't understand exactly the process that they go through, that maybe this will help clarify some things. First of all, the motor coach operators do have a very extensive planning cycle. They plan about a year or so in advance. So if you are to implement a fee of some sort, I would suggest that they already have their tours bought and paid for at this point. So the people are not expecting to pay an additional fee. That, when, you know, because the lady that's just purchased her ticket from Pennsylvania is going to be coming up here in 2004, has already bought her ticket, and the coach has already paid and made contracts with the hotels, the restaurants, and everybody else they've contracted with, and had not considered that fee when they were doing the planning. So it's going to cause additional costs to them that they just hadn't planned for. So if you're going to put a fee in, I would just suggest that you and I'd be happy to help you out, yet communicate that in advance, at least 6 months to a year in advance with these folks, so that they will understand that, okay, it's going to cost us $40 a bus to get in now. We can add a dollar each to the ticket price, and we can adjust for that. The other thing is that a lot of these tour operators, they come with a group tour leader, they'll come with a driver, and they don't necessarily have a lot of cash on hand. So the ones that have not heard about the fee in advance are going to come up and, you know, when someone says it's $40, and I use that $40 fee, I realize it's a seasonal cost, but most of these tour operators, as was pointed out earlier, are coming one time, except for some of the larger companies, which might have, you know, 20 or 30 departures that go to the same places day after day. So anyway, to have them pull $40 out of their pocket or whatever is just an expense they hadn't anticipated, and something to consider. And tour operators are a finicky bunch. There's no question about it. They are very price sensitive, and they will see $40 fee. You know, as Don Haggett pointed out from Lafayette Hotels, he mentioned that a lot of people he talked with, and people that I've spoken with, and my coworkers have spoken with at various tourism conferences that we've gone to, the bus tour conferences, have they pulled their trips out of Kennebunkport because it's a $35 fee to unload. And it's, you know, it's too bad, you know, because the, you know, Kennebunkport, they, you know, they, the merchants themselves really count on the revenue from the coaches, and it's unfortunate. So I just wanted to make those few clarification points, and certainly if you want to contact the tour operators throughout the country, I'd be happy to help you out with that, if whatever you decide. I'd be happy to leave my business card with someone if you need some assistance. And if you want to just have any questions on the motor coach market in general, I'd be, again, happy to help you out.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Andy Charles. I live on Cherry Circle.
I came in this evening pretty much in favor of the fees. I'm not so sure anymore. There's a lot more aspects to this than meet the eye. It's certainly true that the fort is a regional treasure, but it's funded totally at the local level. That's something that I think has probably prompted the discussion. You know, maybe we should charge a fee to exit instead of to enter. And if the traffic backs up and it gets late and the park closes, then they got to pay that fine.
Yeah.
There you go.
Now, somebody made the comment earlier that if we charge a fee, suddenly we have customers, and I think that's a real cogent point. And rather than forcing people to be customers against their will, let's expand on this idea of having voluntary customers, whether it's hot dogs or sodas or whatever it is. I know we don't want to turn it into a circus atmosphere. We don't want to have a lot of trash laying around. We don't want to turn it into Old Orchard. But look at how many people want something to eat or drink at Family Fun Day, during the art shows, during the events when we allow vendors there. I think there's a real opportunity, not necessarily for profits for the town, for the general fund, but to improve and expand upon this wonderful facility. Maybe someday have real bathrooms. And if nothing else, we can offset the $120,000 or whatever the number is that the town funds, and anything additional can be kept in the fort. I think that's a real opportunity. It would be voluntary. If we don't want to set up and manage food service or drink service or whatnot, hire a reputable vendor, give them a short leash, and keep a portion of the profits for the town in return for the privilege of being given the chance to do business there. I think there are a lot of opportunities along those lines that won't be so objectionable in terms of traffic backups, taking away free access, and still allow us in these really tough times to offset some of the financial burdens that we bear every time we turn and look at another area. Thank you.
What about chocolate tokens of the headlight, perhaps?
Chocolate melts in the summer, but saltwater taffy does not.
My name is Bob Crane. I live at Wayman Road. And I rarely let my wife speak without getting equal time. But I have a very short salient point, which you'll love, Mr. Chairman. what I see as the bottom line here is a great amount of alienation going on. In return for saving $30 a year on your tax bill, you will alienate hundreds of townspeople who are absolutely sick with the very thought of charging a fee at the fort. You'll alienate the neighborhood because, as been mentioned here tonight, the parking problems are going to be quite tremendous. And although perhaps there's a way of handling that, it's certainly going to involve a lot of extra help and extra cost. You're going to alienate the surrounding town populace because of the access problems, where they're going to be waiting in line and they're going to have a terrible time trying to get in the fort, never mind enjoy it. And then you're going to alienate the bus companies, and that's been adequately talked about tonight. And the bottom line is you're going to reduce the museum and gift shop intake, plus the ripple effect that this will have on all other businesses in town. So my question is very simple. Is this the choice you want to make? Do you still want to save the $30? Is this what you want to happen in return for the $30? Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Carl Dietrich. I live at 500 Ocean House. I think the gate and the fee is sort of rude and short-sighted. I live halfway between what I call the three lighthouses, the two lighthouses and Portland Headlight, and I see probably 1,000 or more tourists a year pull into my driveway. And they're coming from the two lights semi-frustrated. They like the everything, but they didn't realize that the two lights, you can't go up there, they're private, there's big traffic there, they get caught down at the end of the road. And so then they're coming along, they come to me and I recommend to go there. If they had to pay a fee, I think they'd just keep on going and say, Kate, well, it was pretty, I sort of caught a little view on Shore Road, but that was it. I really I mean, they come with a pocket full of money. They're asking me, where can I go, basically, where can I go and spend money? I told them, well, you can go out on Casco Bay Lines and, you know, take a little ride around. If you like the Freeport thing, go to Freeport. But you have to go. This is our one thing in Cape. That's what you have to see. If the gift shop, you know, yields, what, $500,000 a year on what I call chutzkies stuff, because I'm in the business of old junk. I mean, I hang my little buoy out there and thousands of people come in. They want to buy something. They're like, well, where's town? Well, you know, it's kind of, there's an IGA and there's, you know. They're hungry. They do have to use the bathroom. That's a little bit of a problem. Everyone has to use the bathroom. But they want to spend their money. I like the idea of, you know, not making someone say, well, it's going to become a Las Vegas, a Freeport. 200 feet from the coast, you know, in the park a little bit, food would be huge. I mean, if you wanted to, if you put an ad in the Portland Press Herald and offered a bid out to great food vendors of Portland, they'd be fighting over it at paying maybe $200 to $500 a day, I believe. I'm just thinking about the parking lot right next door to this building. In the summer, that'd be halfway. People would, if there was even a little hot dog stand there, it would yield the town $20,000 to $40,000, I bet. I mean, I don't see why the Lobster Shack, which I call, you know, the gold mine, should get it all. And then there's the Kettle Cove with the line. and our little store, unfortunately, that folded and, you know, is now, I guess, you know, the lines to the back of the store. A little more business wouldn't hurt. You know, we're not going to turn into Freeport. So I just think it's a no situation.
Thank you. Next.
Thank you. My name is Jim Russell. I live at 6 Macaulay Road. I've been a resident of this town for well over 30 years. And this is the first time I've ever spoke to the council. But it took something like this to get me down here. I'm vehemently opposed to to get into the fort. And there's a couple reasons. One is personal and one is philosophical. Really what we've got going on here is two separate issues that the council really ought to consider. One is the goal to make the fort a self-sustaining entity. And I think that process is already underway with the foundation. So we really don't need a fee for that. That's already going, that's going to happen eventually. The second is, should the fort be a revenue source for the town to help support programs in the town, such as schools and other things? And I should tell you, I have two children that go to Pond Cove Elementary, so I have a vested interest in seeing that the schools are very well supported. But there's a vehicle for that too, and it's called property taxes. And if we do the responsible thing, if we feel that our schools should be second to none, then we ought to pay for them. Or we ought to look for cuts. There are two sides to the ledger, and you have to balance it out. Now, secondly, you know, everyone said, well, we have a narrow tax base, and we don't have strip malls, and we have to look at all the sources. Well, that's why people live here, because we don't want strip malls in Cape Lizard. We don't want factories in Cape Lizard. We want it just the way it is. You know, and the other thing to consider is, you know, we are not an island. We're a peninsula. How would you like it if Maine Medical Center or Mercy Hospital charged you a use fee to go to the hospital? How would you like it if you had to pay $2 more to go to a Sea Dogs game because you're not a resident of Portland? Think about it.
Thank you.
Name's Pete Eastman, same as was last night. I came here undecided, open-minded, open-mouthed, can. I'd really hate to see a fee there. I think you'd have a can of worms, and maybe you could sell the worms to the fishermen, I don't know.
Yeah.
I think a better approach, because we are trying to not raise taxes to the point where people can't live here. I think perhaps a solution for this and other needs might be some sort of tax relief for the now impoverished people who live here and have lived here for most of their lives and they're incomes have not kept up with the tax, working their property value assessment in with their adjusted gross income. And guess what I've been doing the last few days? Damn Schedule D. Anyway, that's the big... But anyway, that's just a thought. Obviously, here last night, listening to the problems about getting more space for the schools and not running to raise the taxes on the old folks. Some old folks can afford it, and some can't. And a lot of the Volvo set and Mercedes and BMW set can certainly afford a little more on their property tax. But some can't. So I suggest comparing property value and adjusted gross income to try to resolve that.
Thank you.
I don't know if it's legal or not.
Yeah.
No, unfortunately it's not. Not through here.
I'm Henry Adams, Todd Road. I was on the Cape Elizabeth Town Council when Fort Williams Park was created. And I remember the entrance road and the discussion we had in building it. We kept it narrow so it would be in tune with the rest of the roads in Fort Williams. As Paul Phillips said tonight, if we have to put a toll booth in, we're going to have to widen the road, there's going to be construction down there, it will spoil the beauty of Fort Williams. Being on the town council when the fort was created, we had some real estate developers, one who will remain unnamed, offered to buy 30 acres of the fort. There was discussion at the council meeting about it, and I happened to be chairman at the time, and I remember signing the letter and telling this particular developer the fort was not for sale. Over the years, we have been studying the entrance fees to Fort Williams and studying the entrance fees. The same that holds today that it held then when I told them the fort was not for sale, it's not for sale today. Now, I wrote a letter to the Cape Elizabeth Courier. I'm not going to repeat everything that was in the letter, but there is a PS to it. I was hired by the town of Cape Elizabeth. Mike came to the house and he wanted me to head up a project to create the lighthouse and the museum and the gift shop. I told him I'd gladly volunteer to do it. He said, you can't do it. Volunteer, he says, I've got to pay you some money because with accepting the money, you accept responsibility. So Michael very generously paid me $50 a week. After taxes and deductions and this and that and the other thing, I got a check every week from the town of Cape Elizabeth for $16.10. But it paid my expenses, the gasoline to go down to the meetings and back. But we created the museum, we created the gift shop, and it has blossomed ever since. So I guess I'm going to put a P.S. to my letter that was in the Cape Courier. Don't take my dream that I've had down there at Fort Williams and turn it into a nightmare. Thank you.
Thank you.
Joe Foley. I don't know whether I lost all of your equipment or not.
Bike is broken.
You want to go home, so we won't look for it. I'm Joe Foley from Spoondrift Lane. I've heard all of these wonderful arguments for and against, and I'm against charging at Fort Williams for all of the great ideas that we came here to hear tonight. But really, this isn't about Fort Williams. What we have is a good faith effort by our town council to raise $120,000 so that we don't impact our tax rate anymore. And so let's look at some more creative ways. Let's not look at Fort Williams. Think back 25 years and you're all mostly too young to know about it. But at that point, the people who were sitting in your places were thinking about paying $200,000 to buy this piece of property. 200,000. Tonight we're talking 120,000. But you put those in perspective, that 200,000, if we were talking about it tonight, would be in excess of $2 million. So we're talking very small amounts of money. Important? Yes, I agree. But let's put it in perspective. The people then had the courage, and $2 million then was a lot of money. It's a lot of money today. And those people had the guts and the courage to say the people of Cape Elizabeth want this marvelous piece of property to be used for all of the people of Cape Elizabeth, all of the people of Maine. And they had the guts to stand up and do that. And we have all benefited, our families have, over the years. It's been a marvelous resource, and we shouldn't ever forget it and forget those people that had the courage to do that. So tonight we're talking $120,000, and let's look for another way to do that. It isn't an us and those people fighting. Let's look at some other ways. It isn't necessarily Fort Williams to be the answer to this problem. Let's find another creative way. Thank you.
Thank you.
You see it?
Yeah.
Well, the podium is free. I will close the public hearing then, and I want to thank everybody. The comments were very good, whether pro or con, favor or opposed or whatever, and I really appreciated the tone of most of everybody's comments. They were direct and to the point, and so to that I say thank you. What is, obviously we don't need motions, it's basically up to discussion from the council. Who would like to lead off? Councilor Barry.
Well, I was on the council in June 1970, and I am old enough to remember that. And there was a proposal that had been worked on quite hard by a committee that was working to put high-rise housing in Cape Elizabeth. And in June 1970, in the basement of this building, there was a vote that was held, and there was a 7-member town council. I was on the first town council from 1967 to 1971. And there was a 3-3 vote for and against high-rise housing in Fort Williams. And I cast a fourth vote to prevent high-rise housing from going into Fort Williams. And I haven't changed my mind since then. I think it ought to be kept free.
Thank you.
33 years ago.
Ann? And I can tell you, Ann, because we're not so formal tonight.
Okay, Jack. I, first of all, really want to thank everybody. This is a thorny issue, and I know you all appreciate how complex this issue is. I really believe, like Paul Phillips said, in studying all the data. I went back and read all the reports. I bothered Barbara Ray in her last day at work and dug out all the chronologies and old reports, and I'm sort of a data hound, so I looked it all up. So I have really studied this issue. I want to thank everybody, not just here who just spoke, but everybody who wrote letters. And I know many of the people who just spoke did write letters and mostly emails. I know I've responded at least through 6 o'clock today, responded to everybody, probably ad nauseum for some. I had a somewhat lengthy reply. I got 69 emails from residents through 6 o'clock today. 48% were pro fees. 52% were against fees. So what I think that demonstrates is that there's a significant number of people on both sides of the issue, or I shouldn't say both sides, I should say all sides, because the pro fees ones ranged from fees on everybody, fees on buses, fees on out-of-towners, fees only on people from in-town. The spectrum was amazing, but I appreciate everybody's ideas and the fact that they were really engaged in this process, because it's truly democracy in action, and I think we come to better decisions when more people participate. So why are we here tonight having this workshop? The October 1976 statement of Fort Williams philosophy states, and this is from one of those old reports, quote, "Fort Williams is a unique community resource," unquote. I agree completely. I've been going to the fort for years. It also states that the park's uses should be, quote, "within the financial capabilities of the town," unquote. The 99 report on making Fort Williams financially self-sufficient recommends against instituting admission fees because the fort is not, quote, "an undue financial burden on the town," unquote. At that time, the town subsidized the park by about $85,000 a year. We're here tonight talking about fees at Fort Williams because the economy has changed. The school department has received significant cuts in state aid. The municipal side of the house has also gotten some pretty severe revenue cuts. The economy is bad. You all know what's going on in the state of the world. These factors have forced us to reconsider this issue and its pros and its cons. The town citizens currently pay about $120,000 for this municipal park to be free to not just the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, but to all the rest of the visitors from Greater Portland, Maine, and the rest of the world. In other words, Cape taxpayers currently pay an average of $30 per household, not just to use the parks themselves, which I think is quite a bargain, given all the recreational opportunities it provides, but also to let the rest of its thousands of visitors and users enjoy it at no cost. Those users pay nothing towards the upkeep, the maintenance, and the improvement of Fort Williams. The proposal, just to outline, and I think I can tell from some of the letters I've gotten that there is confusion on some people's part about exactly what was proposed. Councillor Lynch proposed charging $5 a car and $40 a bus for a season's pass. Those who walk or bike in would get for free. Fees would be collected from 9 in the morning to 7 at night from May 1st to October 20th. Based on the town manager's estimated numbers of vehicles, this plan would generate a net after operating costs of $200,000 a year. Initial costs to broaden the road by the beach parking lot and to build a toll booth would be about $100,000, which would be recouped after about half a season, going by the assumptions that the manager made. I would encourage discussion on two details with which I differ on from Councillor Lynch's plan on two details. I would like to see us discuss charging $0 for Cape Elizabeth residents. You would get a sticker when you register your car. You would just be given a sticker. So every car that was registered in Cape Elizabeth would get a sticker, no matter how many cars a family had. And I would also like to see the money generated go towards the benefit of the park as opposed to the general fund. I have tried in all my decisions as a counselor, I try to carefully look at the pros and the cons and really try to weigh the facts before I make a decision. So in evaluating the proposal, I made a long list of everybody's reasons that everybody came up with, and all from the past reports, all the reasons that we shouldn't do it, all the reasons that we should do it. So the arguments against, I would like to briefly address. Traffic congestion. I think moving the booth up toward the beach would allow any backup at peak times to not reach Shore Road. Most local, i.e. Maine users, would have stickers before July and August, which is the peak traffic time, and so those people would not have to stop the booth. They would just get waved through. And I would also think that if there was a problem and traffic started to, you know, really expand down towards Shore Road on a really busy Saturday afternoon, I would give the authority to the toll booth person to say, you know, wave them through. Just wave them all through. I mean, we don't want to have a big traffic problem down on Shore Road. And that would also apply, I think Mrs. Crane mentioned,
someone mentioned, I'm sorry, I can't remember who said what at this point, mentioned on special days like Beach to Beacon. I think we could waive fees for special events. So that's traffic congestion. Parking in adjoining neighborhoods. I think tourists from out of state, which is 70% of the users of the fort, according to the studies I read, and the main users from outside of Greater Portland, which is another 11%, I think they're unlikely to drive in, turn around, drive out. They may decide to drive out, but I think they're unlikely to then go find a place in a neighborhood to park and then to walk in, because it's quite a hike. I don't think tourists are going to find it's unusual to pay for going to a great attraction like the fort. Cape users, especially if they got free stickers, would be very unlikely to park outside the fort because they'd be getting in for free, so they'd be going in for free. The only ones who might want to park outside the fort and walk in would be frequent Greater Portland users who would know the neighborhood. This is only 11% of users. Since a parking pass for a year would be $5 for the season versus the $20 to $30 for a season pass at other municipal parks we looked at, I doubt many would try to evade the fee and park elsewhere. However, in case there were, we will have to enforce parking rules for those that do try to evade it. And what that means is posting any local roads, no parking, and posting placed at park for Little League parking only. Physical changes to the park would, I believe, be pretty minimal. There would be a small toll booth and a wider road up by the beach, which I think probably might be helpful to widen it right there anyways, at that curve, sort of where it curves around to head towards the headlight. Fourth, the objection that some people had that no one else, other towns, don't charge for uses of parks. I think that's untrue. Some do not, but plenty do. Scarborough charges for their municipal parks, not the state parks, but their municipal parks at Ferry Beach and Pine Point. A season resident pass there is $15 to $25. Wyndham charges for Dundee Park. A season resident pass there is $30. Freeport charges for Winslow Park. That's $1.50 per person per day. Raymond charges for Tasseltop Beach. A season pass there is $40 a car. Kittery charges for Fort Foster Park. A season pass there for residents is $10. Most state parks, including Crescent Beach and Scarborough Beach, a season vehicle pass is $50. For those who have mentioned, and in good faith, I'm not trying to pick on anybody, but for those who have mentioned places like New York City Central Park, Boston Common, the Washington Mall as free, well, indeed, there's no charge to walk onto them, but I've been to all those places, and I had to pay parking when I got there. There is a charge to park there, and as I recall, it was anywhere from $12 to $24 a day. So I'm not trying to say there aren't any parks that are free, but there are plenty that are not locally. As for the negative image in neighboring communities, the negative image of charging fees, I don't think anyone here in this room, I know I don't, think less of Scarborough, of Freeport, of Wyndham, because they charge a fee for their municipal parks. I don't think anybody in this room thinks less of those towns because they charge a fee. Frankly, anyone who now thinks Cape is elitist or snobby because we don't while we're not charging a fee, they're still going to think so, even if we do charge a fee. Anyone who doesn't think we're snobby or elitist, I don't think they're going to think any differently upon hearing that we need to charge $5 for a season pass to help pay for the maintenance of this beautiful park. And I was surprised but very pleased to see the editorial in the Portland Press Herald that basically said it was perfectly understandable that Cape would be looking to fees. Six, the negative impact on gift shop and museum revenues. I am not convinced that bus companies will stop coming if we charge $40 per bus per season. I have learned tonight that we should give plenty of notice, a year's notice, so that we don't mess things up for the business tours that are already set up. But I think that fee works out to a few pennies per passenger, which they will pass along to their customers with little or no impact. Those customers will still come and they will still spend, I believe. Lastly, the objection that fees will limit townspeople's ability to freely enjoy the park. I still think, especially if we have a zero cost for Cape residents,
that everyone is going to be able to bike or walk in for free. Cape Town's people could drive in for free for $5 or for zero, which is what I'd like to see, which is considerably less than what they pay now, which is $30. It's just paying in a different way. Right now, Cape citizens do not freely enjoy Fort Williams. Only the tourists do. So those are all the arguments against. The arguments for the $200,000 net generated a year will be used to improve the park facilities. Making the park financially self-sufficient will increase the chances of its perpetual preservation and improvement. I think we have to be good fiscal stewards of this park. And I think given the challenging state of the economy, the Fort Williams Charitable Foundation has had a real tough time trying to raise money, and they're going to have to try and raise $4 million to generate enough money to, $4 to $6 million to generate enough money to throw off $120,000 a year so the park could become self-sufficient. And frankly, I don't think we would need the fund foundation if the park supported itself. The second benefit, the argument for, would be lower taxes for Cape residents. Instead of paying $30 a household for the park, taxpayers would pay $5 or $0 per year, which is a net savings. In a time when school aid is being cut by $486,000 and municipal revenue sharing is down, we could use the money. Lastly, fees would be paid by those who use the park. The Fort Williams Advisory Commission has recommended increased fees for users, for weddings, for filming, for the picnic shelter, for building rentals, and they've also recommended higher fees for non-residents as opposed to residents. This vehicle admission fee would follow the same concept that they have endorsed, that those who use the service pay for it. So I see little or no reason why Cape Elizabeth homeowners should be paying for bus companies to use the park free as a way to generate profits for their companies. Why not have the bus companies and their customers contribute to the upkeep of the park when they contribute to its wear and tear? So I know I've been long-winded and I appreciate it, but to summarize, in this difficult fiscal environment, I am committed to looking at every potential revenue source or expense savings possible in Cape Elizabeth. Fees at Fort Williams and the fort's financial self-sufficiency are one way I believe we could ensure the long-term preservation of this jewel. Henry is correct. I mean, right now it seems ludicrous to us that back in 1970, I was shocked to learn that there could have been high-rises or commercial development being put in the park, urban renewal. It seems sort of ludicrous now, but as fiscal pressures increase, and I don't think they're going to get any less, the pressure becomes greater and greater upon future councils and future citizens to carve off a little chunk here or to do something or to bring in commercial vendors or to do some other things that we wouldn't want them to do. And I think if the fort were self-sufficient, it would really relieve that pressure and would help preserve the park that we know and love. There are indeed potential risks and drawbacks, but I'd like to see us try this idea of fees for a one-year trial period to see how it works out. If it doesn't, if the big problems ensue, we could stop the trial period and change back to the status quo like we did with the library copying fees. Our only investment would be recouped in half a season, so the financial downside is quite limited. The potential upside is great and makes this an idea worth trying, I believe, for the sake not only of Cape Elizabeth taxpayers, but also of the long-term preservation and enhancement of this most valuable resource, Fort Williams Park, of which we are stewards. And I thank you for your patience and for your input.
Carol.
I've been a lot, every time this issue has come up, I just do not support fees at the fort. But I didn't like the idea of it coming forward, but I must say that every once in a while I think it's good for the community to get here and have an outpouring of emotions about Fort Williams and why it's so important to the community. So I guess I think the discussion is just really good. I first got involved in the town by getting involved in the issues of Fort Williams. I started coming to the meetings of the study committee when we were just deciding what would be done with the fort, and all of that was fascinating, and I think Fort Williams is the most important thing we have in this town, and so sharing it with the rest of the region, and I just think is a wonderful thing. I think that fees would have a very negative impact on a lot of features in Cape Elizabeth. I think it would have a huge impact in the traffic and the neighborhood, impact on the money we get in the gift shop. There'd be enforcement costs. I think there's problems with methods in collecting the money and the ability to... can't read my writing, but provide for what we've set up as a method, I think, for the fort to be self-supporting. And I really do think that there are many sources of revenue that we have created. I think the most important coming up, at least, and I don't think we've given it a chance, is the charitable foundation. They've just gotten started. I think the intent was to get money from the greater Portland region, and if we had a fee, I don't think that they would be able to do that. The gift shop certainly is an asset, and I think we have put some of the money into improvements around the lighthouse. And I will be able to do more of that now that the loan on the lighthouse is paid off. There's the museum admission. We've gotten federal grants to improve the property, and I believe that those federal grants don't allow us to charge our residents differently than we charge people from outside the town. We had the centennial fundraising events. We made lots of improvements in the memorial at the bunker. We've had people contribute benches. We have rent from the officers' row. We have picnic shelter fees, event fees. We've had a donation of the cliff walk. We have garden club volunteers. And we have volunteers in the gift shop. I mean, I think we have a lot of sources of revenue to sustain the fort. So to come to conclusion, I have to go with the many studies that have been done by the Fort Williams Advisory Committee and previous town council decisions not to have fees. I think Cape Elizabeth people use other towns' free parks, and I don't want to start any kind of trend for Bug Light, for Back Cove, for Deering Oaks, all of those parks. And I think it's important that we contribute to the region. So I am opposed to be at the park again.
Again. John, Penny, Marianne? John?
I'm kind of disappointed that this is a workshop and we're not able to talk to each other. I don't like this format. I'm going to stand up and sit here and have speeches. A workshop is for us to talk to each other about these things. I'm not going to be convinced by speechifying on an issue like this. I think everybody knows where I stand on this. A couple issues. I'm looking at, I just happened to dig out my
John,
files on this.
I don't know where you stand on the issue.
I'll tell you on that.
Okay.
I dug out, in fact, Cheryl's complaining I get my musty files out of my basement. I should have let them air out for a couple of days. But I have all the reports going back to 1988, and every single one, even when the fee was going to be a dollar, just a dollar fee to get them, 81% of the people said they were against the fee. The next report, again, a dollar, 69% said they're against the fee. Also, something we didn't talk about, and is the revenues that are currently generated at the fort. And as far back as 1998, $40,000 were generated, not the gift shop. I'm not talking about the gift shop. I'm talking about fees from day one, family crisis, the picnic shelter, binoculars, all that good stuff, generated over $40,000. Today, I'd like to see what that figure is today. I don't know, Mike may have a ballpark figure on that. But if you take that away from the $120,000,
about
$54,000. So if you take that off the $120,000, and I'm suspect that $120,000, I think, and Mike and I had a little debate of this last night, but I think it's closer to probably $110,000. You take $55,000 off that, you know, you're getting down around, you know, $60,000 or something that we're really talking about an operating fee. So that's what it's actually costing the taxpayers, about $60,000 to run the fort. And so you cut that $30 down to $15, in my opinion. So, and as I said, all this adds up. I've never been a supporter of an entrance fee for the fort. I think the traffic problems, that's the neighborhood implications, the change, you have to change the roadway, all that. I agree with that. Turnaround places, I mean, enforcement, all those issues I don't think have been fully studied. I'm a no. Okay, yeah, Mary?
Does the chair have to go last, or can I go now?
You can go.
Good.
I'll go last.
You're going to go last?
I just wonder.
I thought you were going to go last.
I just soon go now. I'd like to get my spiel in, too.
Spiel.
I hate to always have to go last.
I thought he said spiel.
I'll tell you right up front. I'll just say right up front, and then I'll go into my explanations. I'm adamantly opposed to having fees at Fort Williams Park. For over 30 years, the citizens of Cape Elizabeth have welcomed visitors of the fort without having to say, that'll be $5, please. And this has been made possible through the efforts of hundreds of volunteers and contributions from numerous individuals and civic groups. Only 2 years ago, we set about to try and make the fort more self-sufficient. Has this been a great success? No, not yet. But to measure success against the last 2 years isn't really fair. And we may need to make some adjustments to help make it more likely. And one of those might be to put some deed restrictions on that property so that it can't be carved off the fund can raise more money. And I would be in favor of that if that's an issue of why that foundation is not working. Other than charging admission fees, are there other ways to increase revenues? Many locations license the use of images, such as the Portland headlight. I don't know if that's something we could do or not, but you see it on every advertisement going in the country, even putting stripes on it by Land's End.
Yeah.
Perhaps we should look at that and other ways to generate new funds, and several were suggested tonight that made a lot of sense, so I won't repeat those. The manager was asked to give us a figure of what he thought we could raise through fees. And I suspect he would be the first to admit that it was totally unscientific and could be completely inaccurate, especially since we have no way of calculating how many people that currently just drive right in and right out, take a quick look at the lighthouse, and would not bother if we were charging a fee. So you can take that traffic count and just throw it right out the window. And how do we measure the potential loss of volunteers at the museum and the gift shop? Would they continue to give their time for a profit enterprise? I don't think so. I wouldn't. And what about the generous contributions from service clubs like Rotary, who have in the past painted the keeper's quarters, provided the seed money for the picnic shelter, funded the restoration of the rock wall at the pond, purchased the flagpole, and are currently proposing to replace the doors on the fire barn building? Would our club continue to do that? Probably not. Not if you're charging a fee and was for profit. Would Gus and Marjorie Barber have been so generous in seeing that the cliff walk became a reality? Not likely, if it was a for-profit park. The Chamber of Commerce has told us in no uncertain terms that many bus companies will avoid the park if a fee is changed, regardless how token it might be. Are we willing to take that chance? I'm not. We make too much money at the gift shop. Yes, fees are charged at a few neighboring locations. As often as not, this is designed for safety. It is intended to limit the number of people who enter at one time. And we're not out to limit the number of people who use Fort Williams Park. We give lip service to sharing regional resources for the betterment of all. Do we really want to see fees at Payson Park, Willard Beach, Deering Oaks, and every other attraction we take for granted as members of the greater Portland community? These communities are facing the same budgetary shortfalls we are. Fort Williams is a multi-purpose facility. We have ball fields, picnic areas, sightseeing, you name it. And backed up traffic is an issue. When you have 100 soccer moms heading to the fort at the last minute, as they all do, to drop off their kids to play soccer, the last thing they want to do is get stuck behind a tour bus or other people trying to get waved through. They'll be back right onto the shore road. And you know that people will back out if they have to pay the fee. I think Gene's statement that half the people that go into the museum, they see a $2 fee, they turn around, they don't bother to pay. Shore Road is one of the most beautiful roads in the entire state. And you don't want to see no parking signs posted on both sides of the road every 100 feet for a half a mile in either direction. That would be lovely. And what about Family Field? This wasn't really brought up. We have the Little League there. Where are Little League families supposed to park if the entire neighborhood is posted? The parking at the field is not large enough now as it is. And with visitors coming at Fort Williams, filling it up, it'll be a disaster. I guarantee it. Our police department does not need this headache, and trust me, it'll be a massive headache. And who is going to decide which days we will waive the entrance fee? Certainly on Family Fun Day, then there's the Portland Symphony Orchestra on the 4th, Beach to Beacon. How about those days when people pay a fee to use the park? Will they be charged to get in as well? Somehow I suspect Engine One Company won't be excited about charging fees when they have their art show. They depend on a lot of people coming in and becoming buyers. How many potential purchases will they lose because they've turned off by a fee? I think I've listed about 14 very good reasons why I cannot support a fee concept at this time. If sometime in the future someone can demonstrate to me that our own residents are unable to use the park, I would obviously feel differently and vote and want to reconsider. But now is not the time. There are way too many negatives to justify it. A fee could kill the goose that laid the golden egg. And I honestly believe that we're talking about money here is that we'll have a net loss of revenue to that park if we implement a fee. Thank you.
If you want to point.
No, I won't say anything other than I can count to four. 1, 2, 3, 4. And again, I appreciate everyone who came, mailed, called. I think we needed to discuss it. And Penny, I'm sure, is going to become five. So with that, I won't prolong the night any longer.
Sure, you're right. You know, when you have these kind of public forums, we're all up here writing down. So we've got our yes columns and our no columns. And I'm always interested in where people live, so I have to try and listen to their street address. And then I don't know exactly what I do with those lists all the time. I think it's just something to do while you're all talking. It gives us something to do. But then when you also talk, when people talk, I'd say, well, I got to respond to that, and I got to respond to that. So I have this whole sheet of things now that I have to respond to, you know, the things that people made about expanding the size of the building and why we have no commercial base in this community. It's because the citizens choose not to have a commercial base. It's not because, you know, we're keeping people up. Citizens choose not to do that. So, but I've decided it's not worth answering all those questions because this is like looking out here preaching to the choir. I do think it's nice that I know all those people, that the yes people that came here tonight for fees, were the school people who were here last night. I recognize them, and I recognize them as sitting here. And they are in a very frustrating situation. They are very, very anxious to put forward their school plan, and they need money to do it. I know they're just frustrated about it. So I can understand where they would look to the fort or whatever the source is to find the monies to do that. That is, of course, one of the major concerns I would have is that it becomes a funding source and that organizations all over the community, I mean, we have this spectacular theater group who needs to go on their trip because they've won this wonderful prize. So, you know, that would be a group where, of course, you'd say, well, let's put another quarter on the fort fee. Or we need new football goalposts, we'll put another quarter on the fort fee. So you can't help but look at a resource like that if you've got fees in there to raise funds. I was interested to see Jimmy Russell. I speak to these because Jimmy, you're among the youngest of the people who spoke tonight. And it was during this time that we've been getting the emails here, it's and the letters, and I've been getting quite a few phone calls. I think people probably knew my position. And I only got one-sided phone calls, so, and that were all for against fees. So it was only 2 or 3 weeks ago that I mentioned to the manager this interesting demographic breakdown of the people who are against fees. It is almost entirely people who lived in the community for many, many years. Most of the people are retired or nearing retirement age. And I found that to be very interesting. I understand the younger people, especially the ones who are here tonight, were school people, and so they have a purpose, you know, they have a need that they're trying to fulfill. So it's very interesting that the same people that we're talking about, the fixed income people, the people that aren't working right now, are the same people who do not want fees. I found that to be one of the most interesting things that's happened in the last 2 or 3 weeks since we've been getting that. And I'm not going to speak to all these issues because it's hard for me to stand up to say, well, we need the money for the schools, we need the money for the roads, we need to increase revenues. And the only reason that I really don't want fees is in my soul. You know, I can't answer these factual people. I can't answer the two counselors to the left of me who list down all these facts and also prepared this fabulous material because I have nothing prepared. And I can't answer that because it is from my soul. I was here, I remember in the 60s when for 10 years, when we got this in 1964, for 10 years we struggled in this community what to do, what to do, what to do. You know, I have a little cartoon. I have a very old Fort Williams file that started well in the 60s. And there's a little page with a little cartoon on it. And it's got a little sort of wizzled up man with a cane and a long beard. And underneath it says, a Cape Elizabeth resident waiting for urban renewal to come through. Because we had an urban renewal authority in Cape Elizabeth because we were going to build the luxury apartments and the low-income housing. I have a letter that will be in the Courier this week, and one of the things that people don't realize, one of the other things that was thought about is the Boys Training Center to relocate here. I mean, a lot of things have come and gone. And my letter that I put in the Courier, the only thing I can say is, for me, it's not about the money. None of it is about the money. We've got everything, I just feel, and I'm not here to change the world, it's only my personal feeling, that everything we do, for our children especially, is about the money. It's about the label on your shirt, the label on your sneakers, the toys you're doing, the where you're going, the vacations, the skiing, everything is about the money. And here we have something that people can use that's not about the money. Everybody can use it equally. And all of the reasons that I stand against fees and have always stood against fees from the day we got that wonderful space over there is it's just not about the money. There's no other answer for it. It's just for me, not about the cost, not about the money. It's something about the inside. Now, whether that takes living in this town a long time, I don't know. But it seems to be the breakdown, and I'm hoping that I know how frustrated the school people are, and I'm hoping that they can understand that there is this other point of view. And none of us are saying, let's not do the schools. I'm just saying, let's not do the fees. So I think Councilor Lynch is right. We're not here to vote, but if the chair takes the consensus, this is a budget item for us. This came up during our budget process, and this is the result of it. And I assume that he'll take a consensus, and I assume that this will end for this budget process as a discussion. I don't know.
I believe so. John is correct. It's still part of the budget. And we may want to talk amongst ourselves, just to iron anything out. Some of the suggestions that come up tonight for other possible ways of implementing some additional revenue from the park that may come up as part of the budget process.
But we are taking a consensus against fees at the end.
I don't think we need to take the consensus. I think they made it pretty clear.
I can't.
And so, again, would like to just say that we appreciate everybody coming out, appreciate your comments. I have to admit there were 125 emails on my computer this evening after I called out all the crap that, you know, we all get. I have not been home since a week ago Tuesday any single evening, so I have not responded to your emails if you sent me one, and I apologize for that, but I will get back and try to read them the first evening I get home.
So. I just wondered, are you done? I just wanted to say that I wanted to thank you, like others, so much for coming out. Chris, it's important for me because you're all agreed with my position, so it's great to great to see you out there. You know, I really loved having you there. It's so much easier it's so much easier to sit there because you have all these wonderful things to say. But indeed, you did feel strong enough to come out for this and come out on what I understand is a rotten night because I heard the plow go by. Mm-hmm. So it's really terrific, and this is the way, I mean, in my history of being on different boards and on this group, a lot of people coming out and making the effort means a lot as to how we respond, certainly how I respond up here. And so I truly do appreciate it. And I love the little no things, whoever got organized on the little no things. That's great.
I
would just like
not
to...
Not me.
Jack, I would just like to echo these comments that Councillor Carson made. I really appreciate everybody coming out. I really especially appreciate the tone of the meeting. The comments were really great. And I mean, I knew going in, I was pretty sure where this was going to go. But I think, I truly think it's worthy of discussion. I think it's a really important issue. And, you know, it's democracy in action. And we came out with what the consensus was. And I think it's good. But I just really want to thank you because I thought the comments were very well put. And I heard a few ideas here that I hadn't heard before and some things other than fees that I think we should perhaps look into or have the Fort Williams Advisory Commission look into. So thank you very much.
Okay. Jack, you might want to remind people that there's a budget form coming in case people want to have their input on their taxes. There is a budget form coming up on March 31st.
Yeah, March 31, we are starting our budget, and there will be a forum, so people can keep that in mind. Information on it will be on the webpage, www.capeelizabeth.com.
And that's to comment on every aspect of the budget, school budget, town budget, county budget, community services, what your priorities are.
We got a few, 2-3 minutes here.
Yeah.